Here.
Counselor Barry.
Here.
Counselor Fritz.
Here.
Counselor McGinty.
Here.
Counselor Roberts.
Present.
Counselor Swift Kayata.
Here.
Counselor Watson.
Here.
Representative Clucci. Representative Elia.
Thank you. Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Do we have any presentations? No. Are there any reports and correspondence? Counselor Roberts.
Madam Chairwoman, the last council meeting I had mentioned that we had a dearth of applications for the different boards and commissions. We've gone from 3 applications at that time to 23, and we have at least one person who has put their name on for at least every board and commission at this point. So I am, although we are heavily weighted in the zoning and planning boards, I don't know why everybody wants to get on those, but we're in good shape, and I want to thank people for getting their applications in. And please, no more. We're all set. We got our calendar all scheduled to interview people this Wednesday, Thursday, and next Monday, and we should have folks to bring back to the council for the December meeting.
Great. Thank you. Counselor Barry.
Thank you. I had 2 items, Madam Chairman. One was congratulating the folks of Cape Elizabeth and the Fire Department Rescue Unit for going over the top, according our on our thermal imaging units for the Fire Department. Heat-seeking units that are very helpful in that fire situation. And number 2, there's good news tonight in West Palm Beach, Florida. It has nothing to do with the presidential election. It has to do with the field hockey team, the Down Easters from the state of Maine, who this afternoon brought home a gold medal. And 13 people were there, 17 people were from Maine on the Down Easter team, the field hockey team. And they brought home, they were undefeated. And 4 of the members of that team were from Cape Elizabeth. And they are Heidi Hanna and Megan Entwistle and Lacey Rentel and Thaddea Rentel. And I think that we all owe them a vote of confidence for their good work for Cape Elizabeth.
Thank you very much.
And also, Councilor, I want to mention the coaches, Becky Blue and Deidre DeLilly, who did a wonderful job in putting that team together. And the mothers, Liz Lane and Michelle Putnam, who worked so hard to bring home that gold medal for the state of Maine and Cape Elizabeth.
Thank you very much, Councilor Barry. Are there any other reports, correspondence? Town manager's report. No report. Is there any citizens' discussion of items that are not on the agenda? Hearing none, we'll move to approval of the minutes of the November 13th meeting. Councilor Barry.
Madam Chairman, I'm going to move to approve the minutes of the November 13th town council meeting as read and compliment our town manager for doing such a good job in the place of our regular clerk.
I'll second that.
Any more discussion? Moved and seconded. All those in favor? Opposed? None. Thank you very much. Moving up to item number 52, it's a public hearing and action upon proposed purchase of property at 343 Ocean House Road at the cost of $560,000. I wanted to just do a little very brief so that you understood where we were coming from here on the council. On September 27th, which is exactly 2 months from today, Wayne Murray dropped into the visit Mike McGovern, the town manager. And at that time, he told Mike that he and his wife, Virginia, who are co-owners of the building at 343 Ocean House Road, that they thought they would consider putting the building up for sale. Several months before that time, the school board and the town council had had a joint meeting to talk about upcoming issues and what both of the boards were doing. The school board at that time informed the council that they had several space issues that were coming before them that they were in the process of dealing with that would impact the schools in the next 2 to 5 years. And that's complicated size classes and different moving around of different classrooms. So they were informing us of those space needs. One of the things that they did tell us is that absolutely for sure they would need the space in the lower level of the 1930s building where the community services is now located. And I'm not going to get into those issues because those are school issues, but we do know as a town council that the community services program will be asked to move from that location. And it's the need to, as we began looking for where we were going to locate community services, which is an enormous program in our town, hundreds and hundreds, thousands of people are actually served by this program. So we knew that it was important, and so this was on the back of our mind. So at that time, when Kay Wayne Murray stopped into the office and the manager called me, we immediately began to work on the fact, would this be a location that would work for community services? So we were not out looking for property to purchase, we were out looking to solve a problem, which is to locate community services. And this is an opportunity that presented itself to us, and this is how we began to act on it. That being said, I'm going to open the public hearing. Everybody, we'd like everybody to try, I assume everybody's here to talk about that, to confine their comments to around 3 minutes, and that it is not the time for the council, when you're making your comments, that's an information time for us, it's a time for you to be heard and for us to hear your comments. It is not the time for us to get into a debate back and forth with question and answers. But when the public hearing is over, all the councilors can feel free to ask anybody to come up or to direct any questions to any people who have information that they want to know more about. But we really do want to caution people not to get into this sort of question and answer in the middle of a public hearing, because it's not really fair to other people who are waiting also to speak. So that being said, I will declare the public hearing open. And please, when you come to the podium, please give your name and your address so that it could be down as part of the record, and then we're happy to listen to your comments.
My name is Ernie Losi. I am a member of the Community Service Advisory Commission. I've been on it, I guess, for about 7 or 8 years, and I think, Madam Chairman, you probably have really put this thing together quite well, as far as I'm concerned, because a lot of what I was going to say does involve that. Each year, there are roughly 6,000 participants in this program, and they range from anywhere, from daycare, all the way up to senior citizens. And all of this is being taken care of strictly by 5 staff members who have been moved, in the time that I've been there, twice. 3 times, and now we are going to be in a position when this takes place, when there are no longer any places left for it, we don't know where it's going to go. This may be the answer to the problem. And hopefully there'll be enough room when this happens that they'll be able to incorporate those things that we have seen that they need so badly. Space, the conference rooms, etc., all the way down the line, because there is such a need for all of this. You have it in your power right now to solve this problem, and I certainly hope you will look favorably upon this, because the residents of this area need something like this to turn to. Thank you very much.
My name is Mary Jean Morf. I live at 4 Ocean Avenue, and I'm also a member of the Community Services Advisory Commission. Both Ernie and I have been members of that commission for approximately 6 years. We've been able to experience quite a bit and see the extent and the scope and the magnitude of the programs that are delivered by community services. So I just want to read briefly some of the numbers and talk about some of the programs so that people understand that community services serves preschool through to senior citizens. During the past year, they ran adult education programs for 2,000 adults. They set up and coordinated ski and soccer programs for 1,400 students. They served 120 families through extended care. They managed the new pool and the fitness center, where 200 people use that facility every single day. They set up after-school adventure programs for 600 students. They planned and operated a summer rec camp for 900 children, planned and managed activities for 200 seniors, scheduled more than 50 events in facilities that include the schools, Shore Road, and Fort Williams. And then in their spare time, they supervised the buses and the bus drivers for 1,200 kids coming and going to school every day. For those of us, and I think most of us, have experienced some type of community service program, we know that Sooner staff do this by going to the events, and they're hands-on managers to those events. In order to do that, they need to be located in proximity to these events, which primarily happen in the school. It's the only way that they can efficiently and effectively continue to manage the programs and the multitude of programs they do. So it's really in their best interest, but it's also in the town of Cape Elizabeth's best interest to locate them in that facility. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Andy Bernstein. I live at 19 Trundy Road. I'm not going to add to what the people who've said in support of community services. My wife, my children, and I have all benefited from community services. I use the fitness facility every day. But I simply wanted to point out, as I'm sure you already know, that the building in question is really the only building of its type that may be available for a long time in the town center. And it's a unique opportunity for the town to use this building for town needs, whether it be community services or in addition, I know that we have an acute need that's about to come up in a couple of years from the kindergarten, which is currently located in the high school. My son is, I think, in the class, the seventh grade class, which is the largest class, I think, in the Cape system currently, and that's the class that's going to cause the burden on the high school. So between the kindergarten and the community services, I think we have a need. And for a building that is, as the last speaker said, in proximity to the schools and to the town center is an ideal solution, perhaps, to many of the town's pressing needs in this regard. And I think, you know, to pass up that opportunity would be a mistake and something we would live to regret for many years to come. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
My name is Marilyn Sherry. I live at 19 Starboard Drive. I agree with everything that people have said prior to me. I disagree with the solution to the problem. This is a wonderful town, and it offers us lots of good things. It is also a town with incredibly limited commercial tax base. And I question removing from the tax rolls a piece of property that might be revenue producing. I just think that we need to look harder for a solution to our problem.
Thank you.
My name is Patrick Cotter. I live at 21 Ocean House Road here in town. I'm also a small business owner. I think the town council needs to really reconsider this whole issue. I've read everything that I get my hands on about this, as far as in the newspapers, what the town has put out, and talking with people. What I haven't seen is how much money this building, which essentially is a barn, is going to cost to renovate. And that worries me. It's, let's spend over $500,000 on a building we really don't know how much it's going to cost to renovate. I know for a fact that it takes a lot of heating oil just to heat it in its present condition, and right now we have to consider that, because heating oil is a huge expense. Also, the woman that was up here before with the tax revenue, I have major concerns that this town is losing some of its best tax revenue. I don't think so. George, have you ever sent anyone to school through the millwork? Because I don't believe anyone's ever gone to school through the millwork. You have two kids in this town. You send two, anyone here have two kids that go to school in this town, you're losing proposition for it. So we need to consider that as far as your property taxes and sending your children to school. It would benefit them in the long run to have this business open. Years ago, we bought a gas station next to the town hall. No one's used it yet. It's just a large parking lot for the town hall. We should look into that as far as building on that instead of building on what is now known as Pond Cove Millwork. I think the town also needs to look into expanding the high school, possibly to incorporate the kindergarten and community services. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Jamie Walsh. I'm from 11 Belfield Road. And I think purchasing this building has its ups and downs. One down is a loss of, like, good things that have gone on in that building. And an up as a good boost for who's using it. And I'm pretty much, I've got a lot of support for both sides. But yeah, that's all.
Thank you very much for coming.
I'm Ann Belden. I live at 56 Stony Brook Road, and I'm the president of the Pond Cove Parent Association.
And I'm Margaret Thibodeau, 21 Salt Spray Lane, and I'm the vice president of the Pond Cove Parent Association.
And we have a letter that we want to read. I just want to make a quick comment before I read it, though, and that's to say, we're a very involved parent group. We organize a wide range of activities throughout the school year for our student and parent population. And we're able to do that because we have such a wide, tremendous amount of parent support. However, I would like to say that when it comes to making a decision to take a stand on an issue such as this, which can sometimes be controversial for people, a relatively small number of people make the decision. Basically, it's the number of people that come to our business meetings. And I don't want to give the impression that although we're the Pond Cove Parent Association, we're not representing all parents at Pond Cove tonight. And we want to respectfully acknowledge that we're sure that there are people in the audience and people who aren't here that probably or might possibly disagree with the stand that we're taking. So having said that, I'd like to read this. Dear council members, on behalf of the Pond Cove Parent Association, we'd like to urge you to consider purchasing the land that's in question tonight for the following reasons. The location of the building under consideration is a prime location for a multitude of town uses, including many related to the schools. To our knowledge, there are no other buildings in our town center currently available for purchase that could meet such a wide range of needs. Two, the current kindergarten center location continues to be an issue for parents, and it's our understanding that the purchase of this building may be the first step towards being able to relocate our kindergarten. We strongly support any effort to move the kindergarten near to the Pond Cove complex. Three, the PCPA is in desperate need of storage space for our large supplies and projects. We raise close to $30,000 a year, and our supplies for these efforts are strewn about many members' garages and attics. We're in favor of finding any town space that might help to alleviate the situation for ourselves as well as other community groups. And finally, our community recognizes the importance of helping our youth to make healthy decisions, yet our town offers no permanent, appropriate space for teens to gather. Looking ahead to the lives of our grade school children, we want to create an inviting environment where young and older teens may congregate. The purchase of this building may hold possibilities for this in the future. In closing, it seems to us that the building in question could possibly meet such a wide range of needs. While we realize that this will not solve future classroom space issues, it might provide a stepping stone along that path. Thank you. And I've made copies for
Thank you very much.
Good evening. Tom Forcella, 9 Salt Spray Lane, Superintendent of Schools. As most of you are aware, the school board has been actively investigating the facility needs of the school district with a goal of creating a long-range facilities plan. We will be sharing that plan with you when it is complete. I would like to, at this time, share my thoughts with regard to the issue at hand relative to the purchase of proposed space to house community services. After careful review of our present and future space needs, I can tell you that all available school space, including that presently occupied by community services, will be needed for school purposes. From an educational viewpoint, you need to know that we cannot run and continue to run our programs in a manner the people of Cape Elizabeth are accustomed to without additional space. If the town were to purchase additional space to use as a home for community services and their related activities, it would assist the school system with the long-range goal of finally creating a school system where students are housed in the facility that corresponds to their grade and developmental level. Finally, I would like to applaud the council and the town manager for having the foresight to take action on what seems to be a purchase that will surely benefit the entire community. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hello, I'm Marie Prager, and as a school board member and the chair of the School Facilities Committee, which is comprised of school board members, the superintendent, the three school principals, the town business manager, community services director, and parents of Pond Cove, the middle school, and the high school. This past July, the Facilities Committee hired SMRT, an architectural engineering and planning firm, to help us evaluate and determine the long-term space and program needs of our schools over the next 10 years. We've been working very closely with them, and their final report will be available next month, which will then be discussed with the full school board. One of our concerns has been available space in each of our schools as our current student population moves through each school within the next 5 to 6 years and beyond. An early concern, which has now been supported by SMRT, is that our middle school will need the space that community service currently occupies as early as next fall. Our current population of 605 students has exceeded our maximum capacity. 1 year ago, we were at 560 students, and that number will grow again to 624 in the year 2001-2002. At a minimum, we will need 2 additional classrooms. The community services space in the middle school, which is approximately 8,000 square feet, could easily be converted into much needed classroom space. I would like to simply state the need for classroom and program space needs for all of our schools. The opportunity that presents itself for community services to relocate would certainly help the middle school and keep our students in the school building and not portables for the next few years.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Peter Carter. I reside at 21 Ocean House Road, Cape Elizabeth. I also need to identify myself as chairperson of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. I am not speaking on behalf of the planning board, nor am I speaking this evening as an individual member of that board. I do not have any conflict with the town council in considering for purchase any land that becomes available that adjoins town-owned property in its present state, nor do I have any disagreement with the need to expand community services and the fact that it employs, enjoys a very broad political supporting base. However, this parcel is the wrong choice, and there are other sites available. I think the council should be very forthcoming with the public in acknowledging that the present building is never going to be used by community services. It is a two-story residence. It is not ADA acceptable. It's going to cost a great deal of money to renovate it. The barns were built by the present tenant. They were built as temporary structures. And let me just mention lead and mercury. Before 1975, all paints had lead and mercury in them. The residue is still on that site. Just remember what happened when we renovated the elementary school and the middle school. School was delayed, cost overruns were common, and there was a great deal of hazardous waste found. Please don't make the same error again. If you look at this property and also visualize what the entrance and exit roads of the Cape Elizabeth High School look like at the beginning and end of the school day, to add another driveway to Route 77 25 feet away is not sound. I realize the back of the property exits onto town land at the town high school, but it exits onto the circular traffic circle in front of the high school. It is not safe access. I believe, again, there are better sites in town. Pond Cove Millwork has been a strong member of this community. Their checkbook is always open to nonprofit organizations here in this town. And a lot of people don't understand that this is not a small family-run operation. You cannot exist on the east coast of the United States without, in a given week's time, touching something that was made here in Cape Elizabeth. All of the Hannaford supermarkets, all of Shaw's supermarkets, NBNA, many banks, law offices. The podium you're leaning on tonight was made at Pond Cove Millwork. It is a multi-million dollar operation with a $40,000 a week payroll with 63 employees. I think it would be very detrimental to the business community in Cape Elizabeth if they left. And I think it's something we'll talk about many years to come. We have 3 banks in town. These 63 employees cash their paychecks there. That's a very small part of it. If Palm Cove Millworks leaves town, they move their corporate account. That's a multi-million dollar account. We have three marginal banks operating in town. One of them would probably close if they left. That's a big account to lose. I will identify myself as a painting contractor, and I don't want to go to Scarborough to buy my paint. Please understand, when I say other sites are available, we do have a community center building. I realize it's very small and is not of use to community services at this time, but it is situated on a fairly large lot. It has a parking lot that abuts the parking lot behind the town hall. It can be expanded. If what's going on now at the community service center is needed in another building, we have the service station lot next door. It is my understanding, even though it's not on the market, the lot to my left, the open lot by the town hall, could be made available for sale and purchases considered if a very large buffer at the back of the lot was left to protect the two residents which are on the back lot. Again, it is not on the market at this time, but the Tinsman Realty Office has already been approved by the Planning Board for a retail and administrative building of substantial larger size than what's on the lot. Their parking lot abuts the high school parking lot, would allow for safe access and egress from that property without having to build another driveway onto Route 77. I think I'm making a safe assumption, whereas that building is owned by a realtor, that it could be for sale. I simply ask that you consider these things. To kick a business out of town that pays almost $20,000 a year in real estate and excise taxes, a business that many other towns would welcome with tax incentive financing, is just not sane. Allow this business to stay in Cape Elizabeth, aggressively look for another site for community services, and I believe you'll have a much wider support from the townspeople if you do so. I'd like to thank you for your consideration this evening. Good night.
Thank you.
My name is Rob Moriarty. I live at 23 Phillip Road, and I believe that everything said tonight has had a good reason behind it. But me personally, I'm in favor of building a teen center where the paint factory used to be. Because, well, after school, we pretty much have no place to hang out, like after middle school gets out. And we all know the teachers don't want us hanging around near the school after. And I skateboard, and there's really no place to go and skate except at the school where they don't want us to be. And I just think, well, I know how much money it would cost to put in a, like, to refinance and everything there. But I just think it'd be a good investment so we teens can go and hang out somewhere and not be like kicked out of the middle school after. Like, we're not kicked out, but we're just told to leave, if that's the same thing. And like a skate park or something could be put into, and like pool tables and other things inside in the basement. And it does have different floors, so you could use like one floor for like a teen center, another floor for community services or something else, if you could do that. And I just think it'd be a really good investment to put in. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Pam Halfacre, 5 Macaulay Road. I agree with pretty much what everyone said here, especially with the teen center idea. He's right, we really have no place to go after school. But also, I think people have been overlooking the fact that, first of all, buying the house and renovating would cost money, which would have to add on extra taxes, which maybe some people in this town can't afford. And that would also pose a problem. So I think that we should try and find other ways of raising the money instead of adding them on to taxes. And maybe, as that man said, we have plenty of other places that haven't been used yet for the extra space deal. And that's pretty much it.
Thank you.
Good evening. Rosemary Reed, 1 DMA, Cape Elizabeth. I have a little bit of a different tact, and I would ask that the town council chair give me maybe more than 3 minutes because I want to speak on several aspects, and if I go too long, just raise your hand and I'll stop, but I'll be shaking so badly after 3 minutes, I'll probably have to walk away. I understand the issue of taxes, and having served on the town council and the school board, I understand the space needs. I also understand the need to purchase infrastructure, like the building that's for sale next to the school campus for expansion. I want to note a few things. In 1990, when I was on the town council, and we voted to approve the purchase of 1226 Shore Road, we were accused of spending too much money, and we didn't know what we were doing, and the cost to renovate it to the appropriate space would be exorbitant. I would say right now it's a bargain, and I would also ask that if that property were to become no longer needed, if you purchase this property, then that property is a source of funds to help defray the cost of this. I would ask the council to review Table 6 and Table 8 of the town report, which shows that this town pretty much has been low on the debt service end until about the time they had to buy the school. And where a lot of people might be in sticker shock is we went for many years without having a large amount of debt. I remember sitting at the auditor's meeting year after year when I was on the town council, and they repeatedly said that our debt ratios were low, and that's because the town as a whole only bonded when they needed to and paid as they went pretty much, and we didn't have a rapid growth period for infrastructure. Exhibit 6 and Exhibit 8 pretty much show that we have purchased what we need over the years. Our debt ratios are still quite low for assessed value, still well within the acceptable levels, and that we are paying down our debt at about $1 million per year, and I don't know that that's changed that much. I want to thank the council for years ago putting on the, or 2 years ago, the website, and the information that was available today helped me to point out a couple of things. On the website, it showed 8 reasons why this property is being considered. I would also add that there's an additional opportunity for community services to save rent, which is noted on here, but also perhaps to raise additional revenue by offering expansion of some of their programs. I'm also interested in whether or not the sale of 1226 has been factored in, and would that be an appropriate place to have some of the costs for the renovations. I was also, when I was on the town council, a member of the Teen Center Study Group, which really didn't get too far, and we looked at renting spaces down in the shopping center at the Strip and looking at other places, and there was no space available, certainly nothing that was affordable. And the fact that it is so close to the police station, where the police can watch what's going on when these kids, and I'm imagining that most of the kids who would go there would be middle school age and wouldn't have their license. Just think how great it would be for the presence of the officers to be known as the young man who was here before. They're never kicked out, they're just asked to leave. Well, just think how close proximity would allow for another good relationship between the youth and the police and the town. By the way, I support the project. I applaud the town council and the town manager for getting it to this point. And I certainly think that by taking a fine point to some of the costs associated here, some of the costs could be reduced. And that another thing that scares people is whenever they see a project, they automatically think that there's an increase in their tax rate. And there are many different ways to find money in the tax. Some of it's operational, some of it is capital. Some of it is raising taxes, and the other is additional revenues. Just like with the pool project, where we went with option D because it allowed us to have more revenue opportunities, I think that this option would allow for us to solve needs and purchase additional, have additional revenue that might not have been identified yet. And I remind everybody about the museum at Fort Williams. And when that first came online, there were people lining up against that too. And my voice is gone, and so are my minutes. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Susan Walsh, 11 Belfield Road, you already know, but I agree with the other two teens that came up earlier. And I have seen the skateboarders at the parking lot in the middle school, and it is hard for them to kind of skateboard freely around there because of the cars, so they have to be careful of the cars, and they also have to make sure they're not in any of the teachers' ways or anything, and sometimes they're told they should leave or something. And the library, a lot of kids sometimes go to the library after school, and the library is a good place to sit quietly and do homework or research something on a computer if there's one free. But sometimes, like, if a kid's parents work or something, a kid might just go to just not have any homework or anything. And his friend, like a friend of his or hers, they might go to the library and they just might talk or something. But you can't really do a whole lot at the library because it's a nice place and all, but you have to be really quiet. And one time I was there and I went out to get something from the school. And I came back and my friends had been kicked out of the library because they were being a little too noisy. So I think a teen place would be really good for that because that would give kids a better place to talk and socialize and stuff. And I also think that a little bit of a skateboarding place there would be a good idea because of the way that they can't skateboard there. And I agree with the two-story thing, so one floor can be like community services and the next floor can be teen. So that's all I have to say.
Thank you very much for coming.
My name is Russ Halleck, and I live at 2 Dearborn Drive, and I have 45 years. Town's come a long ways in 45 years. But I feel that people in my age group, not young, all of us are on fixed incomes. And every time we spend $500,000 for a piece of property that I don't think we really need, and who knows how much is going to be put into that building to be used or completely demolished and replaced, plus the amount of tax revenue that we are losing, it sure looks to me like it's going to go on my tax bill, which is about all I can handle right now. Now, maybe the town needs a place for the kids. Well, by golly, when I was a kid, we provided our own entertainment. We went to the other people's houses, and we didn't get rowdy. We were welcome there at our house and others. Places that I went, we took care. We went to each other's house for entertainment, and I think of the kids would spend more time understanding each other and living with each other as friends. We wouldn't have to provide a place for them. As far as George Gagnon, I don't suppose he'll be able to stay anyhow, but I want you to know that he's been a friend to a lot of businesses, a lot of people here in the Cape, including myself. Now, I do volunteer work for the Easter Seals Society for Disabled Children, and I make specialty furniture. And the last plywood and stuff I got, you know how much he charged me? Nothing. Now, to me, to take somebody that will do this for a charitable group and tell him that he's got to leave town, I don't think that's right. And I think we can look other places and use some of the property that we already have. As this other gentleman said, we got the old gas station next door. What's it doing? Nothing. Just sitting there. Not even a parking lot except on meeting like this. Why not use some of the property we got? What's the matter with the building over here where the people go in there for a social thing? They got to have something for the kids. What's the matter with having something over there? I don't understand why we all got to keep spending so much money. Thank you.
Thank you.
name's Catherine Miller. I live at 7 Crescent View Avenue in Cape. I'm here tonight not to tell you on how this building potentially could be used. You've heard that many times this evening. I'm sure you have, many of you have your own ideas how this building can be used. The options are really limitless. I'm not here to tell you why the need is so great. You, I'm sure, have all read the article in the Cape Courier saying the overcrowding of the schools and community services faced with no home. My purpose here is to tell you my own experience on the Community Service Evaluation Committee last year. We had the opportunity to evaluate just this, what we needed as a town. The group addressed several things. We addressed what the town needs. Does the town need a community center? What the purpose of the center would serve? What type of space was necessary to accommodate these goals? And how was it going to be paid for? The financial aspect was our the least component. We wanted to really solve whether the need was there and whether what type of space we needed. I'd like to tell you about our findings. Our first finding is that the need was absolutely there. Kids are going to empty homes after school. They're going to CBS. They're going to IGA, the library. And those places are simply unacceptable for children after school. The seniors do not have an adequate space for senior meetings. They don't have a large facility for luncheons. And finally, Community Services doesn't have a home anymore. They will be losing their space. There's not enough space in the existing Community Service to serve the needs of large meetings and different type of community events that they offer. We decided that based on those three objectives, those three needs, we needed something with a large facility, something that could house a large group of people. We needed something with a kitchen, that seniors could have luncheons, that different facilities, different groups could rent out the facility for a fee, allowing the town to recoup some money. We decided that there was a, needed to have a space for crafts that people could set up on tables, play bridge, have different organizations, have conferences there. There's also a need for the teen space. Teens needed someplace to go, hang out, sit on a couch, watch television, maybe have some video games there. Maybe say skateboarding outside. A need for a computer lab was very real. The seniors have voiced the interest in using the school's lab. The school needs the lab for their own students. Competing interests, again, a computer lab was needed. The teens have also voiced an opinion that a snack bar after school would be someplace that they'd be very willing to participate and support. And finally, offices for the community services. Based on those, we've been evaluating the need. We reached out to the elderly population and the teen population and had some surveys completed. And both of those came back clearly affirmatively. People out there would support this. Teens from grades 4 through grade 12 said that they would visit a teen facility every day if allowed, and if that facility was there. After we've assessed the need was there, we said, what type of building is there? And as I indicated a few minutes, it was something that was a large facility. But most importantly, the location was key. We need something that teens can walk to right after school, something that parents could drive by on the way home from work, see the kids there, pick them up, stop in. We need something that policemen can monitor. It's not something in the backwoods. Kids are going in the backwoods for other reasons. We want to get them out there. Let's bring them to the lot. Let them see. Let's see where they are. Let's be proud of our teens there. In assessing what type of building we needed, we also used the other areas, the other communities, to assess what type of facilities they built and what they did learn from their mistakes. We went to Kennebunk as a group, went to South Berwick, and we went to York to visit their facilities. We went, in going there, we found they had all different ways they constructed it, but basically, they had a large facility, they had a large kitchen, an industrial kitchen with industrial appliances, which would allow them to produce large lunches. They had office space, but most importantly, they had that key location, which is what is important. After we've assessed all that, as a committee, our tasks essentially ended. We decided that there really wasn't an adequate facility. We looked at our existing community service building and said this isn't going to be enough. There was nothing we could do to improve it to meet all those needs that we have found. We looked at other areas that the town could build, and we really stretched our heads and said, you know what? There just is not a location that is acceptable. And it ended. We were unable to do anything. Our hands were tied. Tonight, you have the option of making this happen once again. This building that we are considering tonight has the key component. It has location. It has size. It is in close proximity to the school, visible. Parents can stop by, pick up kids. Kids can walk there after school. It has all the things that we, as a committee, decided were necessary. I'm not here to tell you that it's going to be a cheap venture. Absolutely, there will be an expense associated with this. But what we can do is we can draw on the experiences from the other communities. They were more than willing to offer their support and their experience in learning how they were able to lower the cost and raise money. One facility raised $100,000 a year in different fundraising activities. There's different organizations that are going to be using this. There's going to be teens, elderly, and community service. Each of them have their own fundraising opportunities. The teens were in other communities, were more than willing to help pitch in. I'm sure many people in the room would be willing to offer old sofa, old TV, VCR, that would all come together. There are ways to mitigate this. There's also different ways that this center could draw in business. If we're going to be having a kitchen or having different lunches, we could purchase goods from the town, so bringing back some of the business that we would be losing as a result of this business leaving, losing this business from the town. So I've been totally in support of this. I think it's what our community center evaluation committee decided last year was necessary, and I think this is just one opportunity that the town cannot afford to pass up. Thanks.
Thank you.
My name is Don Perkins. I'm an attorney representing Pond Cove Millwork and its president, George Gagnon. I'm a resident of 136 Oakhurst Road here in Decatur. First of all, I don't understand how you address this question without an independent appraisal and without an engineering analysis and estimates about what it's going to cost to convert this building to its proposed use. You're going to pay $560,000 for a building that's on your tax rolls at $344,000. I have heard, and I don't know the accuracy of this, but I have heard talk of there being $1 million to $1.5 million involved in the conversion of this building to its intended use. Now, if you're going to get into those kind of numbers, you really are getting into a financial bath, it seems to me. And I don't see how you address that question without the relevant information, namely an independent appraisal and an engineering analysis. Now, the other points here have been addressed to some extent by previous speakers, so I will be brief. First of all, in terms of community support, Pond Cove Millwork has been a good citizen over the years. They've provided advertising in support of local schools, approximately $2,700. They provided remodeling here in the town hall, tax office, some $12,000. Contributions to the rescue and sea rescue van project of $3,100, support of Boy Scout trailers, some $1,900. They pay excise taxes on a fleet of 22 vehicles of approximately $9,000 each year, and they pay property taxes of something like $20,000. In addition, their presence here in the center of town provides benefit to area businesses. The fuel repair expenses spent at Jonesy's runs about $28,000 a year. Employee purchases of lunches at IGA, etc., approximately $17,000 a year. Local health providers, doctors, dentists, etc., $8,500 a year. And vehicle repair expenses at Bothell's Garage, $7,800. Now, as I stated at our last hearing, The town comes into this picture at a point where the landlord, Mr. Murray, and the tenant were negotiating about a further lease. In fact, they were quite close in their proposals, and it's quite clear to me that had the town not intervened here, their lease arrangement would have gotten worked out. But as it stands, if the town goes forward, Bon Cove is going to have to move this substantial business. Their moving and layout cost of a new facility is estimated to run about $250,000, which will be a damage resulting to them if this property goes over to the town. And so we have a situation where I think that the becoming a competitor with Pond Cove relative to Mr. Murray's building really creates a mess. But more important from the consideration of you acting for the town, it looks like the finances of buying this building and converting it to this use is really going to be a mess. Now, as earlier speakers have said, you've got property next door, you've got property behind this building, you've got the Tinsman property, you've got alternatives that are much better defined in terms of construction cost and getting into redoing this building that's sort of a ramshackle proposition made for manufacturing purposes. And so you could meet your needs in a far better defined manner and at a far more reasonable cost. And so I would urge you to give these matters very serious thought. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I've just got one more thing to say, and then I'll sit down. some people are worried about the cost and or time it would take to renovate the building, but I'm almost positive that some of the kids from the middle school who want this building would volunteer to help renovate it, because I know I would. We could bring in, brooms. I know, if there's, wood needed for floorboards or something, I know my dad has a workshop in our basement, and I would donate those. A lot of people from the school would probably help, because a lot of kids in our school want this teen recreation center.
So. Thank you.
My name is Ann Cranchon. I live at 2 Star Road. I'm here as a member of the community who's been involved with the Cape Community Coalition for a number of years. The young people tonight have expressed better than I would be able to the needs that they feel they have for a place for teens to meet, and I would have to agree that that is really needed. And I also would support the idea of an all-community center with community services and seniors and teens and any other community members. I think I just get very excited about that idea. I think that's very positive and something that the community needs. We don't even have the pizza place anymore to, kind of meet each other. Wouldn't it be great to have a place where we could meet for a cup of coffee and chat as members of Cape Elizabeth? The coalition honestly needs a space too. We have purchased a computer and some office equipment that was used briefly by a Vista volunteer. That did not work out for us, and we no longer have a space that works for us. And the space we were in the community building, was in Paul Gaspar's office, which has issues of access that are a problem, and it's a very isolated location for us. This location would put us right in the thick of things. It would be wonderful to have more than just a post office box in Pond Cove IGA in order to do the work that we're doing. We're completely volunteer. Having a spot with a phone number and a place where even our, especially our young members could come and work on the computer and could write newsletters, et cetera, would be a tremendous help for us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Sue Weatherby. I'm the Director of Community Services. And what I have to say will be somewhat redundant and most definitely biased. So here goes. I have always said that community services could be located anywhere on or near the school campus. Consequently, in the 15-year period, we have been relocated 5 times in order to meet the needs of the school, demographics, and programs. Our most recent move to the 1930s building in February of 99, we anticipated to be our permanent home. However, once again, because of enrollment bulges sporadically spaced throughout the system and a desire to reunite kindergarten at Pond Cove, we find our space needs to be reclaimed for school use. Because there is no longer any swing space in any school building, no shuffling of spaces can accommodate even minimal space for community services. Presently, the community services office and extended school care program occupies about 8,000 square feet in the lower level of the 1930s building. 1,500 square feet of this is for storage. This space is barely adequate to accommodate the daily enrollment of 90 extended school care students. Due to parking restrictions, we have not been able to accommodate more than 6 cars at one time in the lot for the patrons to conduct business in the community services office, nor can we host a program in the community services multi-purpose room. On several occasions, we bust senior citizens from behind town hall in order to utilize our community services multi-purpose room. Would the acquisition of the Pond Cove Millworks work, the acquisition of that building, solve the needs for community services, as well as provide a community building that would enhance the quality of life for all of our citizens? Yes, it certainly would. Let me list the ways. It would provide for more space to expand programs for senior citizens and teens. Having spent more than a year on the Community Center Study Committee, surveying the needs and interests of both teens and seniors, not only to have the project come to a screeching halt because we lacked a suitable space was both frustrating and disappointing. Senior citizen programs are restricted to small groups during the school day or must be held outside the school community in order to accommodate the number greater than 20. A community center would allow seniors a place to drop in, have a meal a couple of times a week, play games, enjoy crafts, or meet others with similar interests. The center would also provide some spaces for teens to gather evenings and weekends. It would provide a large multi-purpose space that could accommodate community services sponsored exercise classes that are currently housed outside the community at a cost of several thousand dollars per year. More preschool programs could be offered that require gym-like space during the day. And for the community at large, a large meeting space other than school cafeterias that are often unavailable. It would provide classrooms and meeting rooms that would be available during the school day as well as in the evening. It would house the Community Services Extended School Care Program, which provides care for over 120 Cape Elizabeth families. Right now, we have the bare minimum amount of space. When we can, we use cafeterias, gyms, computer labs, but they are often unavailable. The center would allow for game room space, gym-like space, quiet study spaces, and perhaps a small computer lab. It would house the Community Services Administrative Offices. It would relieve some of the storage space shortages, not only for community services, but also for the outdoor athletic equipment storage. It would provide adequate parking for community services customers. In conclusion, a community center would be another wonderful asset to this community. It would serve the entire population, preschoolers through senior citizens, allowing program expansion in all areas. We have the programs. We finally would have the space. It would also meet the need of a permanent space for community services. Should the town not purchase the Millworks, it would still need to find a home for community services. There's no space in any of the school buildings, none in the town buildings that I know of, and 1226 Shore Road is too small and located too far from the school campus. The Millbrooks building would not only fill an immediate need, but it also would provide many more opportunities to the citizens of Cape Elizabeth. Thank you for the consideration.
Thank you.
My name is Susan Klopp. I live at 11 Patricia Drive. At the risk of being redundant, it's indisputable that community service is an enormous asset to this community. However, we're looking to purchase a building to facilitate the needs of the middle school and community services. I don't think that the Pond Cove Millworks is an appropriate site. I agree with the gentleman here. It's with the lead paint, the mercury, the probably asbestos insulation in the ceilings. If anyone has walked through the buildings or walked around the building, it is in exceedingly great disrepair. I agree that $560,000 on a property that the town is valuing in the 340 range is excessive. The town owns property next door. There are options behind us. There's also options with the Tinsman building, has been mentioned before. I think we're being a little bit over aggressive in trying to solve the problem and losing sight of the issue. The issue tonight is on the agenda of the Pond Cove Millworks building. I don't think it's an appropriate choice for us. As far as community services raising more revenues by putting $1.5 million into that building, perhaps they could. I use community services an enormous amount. I volunteer at community service a very small amount, but I do find that the new pool, the fitness center, is above market value as far as the price. You can join clubs elsewhere, private or public, for less money. So if we're going to put a community center for the teens and we're going to expect that to earn revenue for the town, we're going to be taking it from the kids, from the parents, and it would not be competitive. The pool and the fitness center is not competitive. It exceeds market value. I think by building on that Millworks site, we would exceed market value once again, be a tax burden to the community, and there are other options. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name's Randy Blake. I live on Ivy Road, Cape Elizabeth. My main concern with the purchase of the Millworks building is the overall impact on taxes to the town. Over the last few years, the town has spent a great deal of capital, a great deal of funds on capital improvements. We have $11 million for a new middle school that supposedly was going to solve many of the problems. We have the new police station, we have the new public works, we have new athletic fields, and now we hear tonight and in the Cape Courier that there's also probably in the future some additional pressing school needs. All of those things are going to add up to increased taxes. Hopefully some of them can be revenue neutral. Maybe the community services can support itself. I'd be very interested to see a budget to see how that would work. So I'm concerned basically with the impact of taxes. I listened to the gentleman before who has struggled to pay the taxes that he's currently assessed. I look towards retirement in a few short years, hopefully, and I am concerned about my ability to stay in my house when I retire with the increased tax burden. Buying this building at this time, I think, is inappropriate because I don't think the town council has adequate information. I think your purchase is a knee-jerk reaction to the availability of the property. We have an appraisal, I guess, that's out there that someone mentioned. We have not determined whether that independently represents an independent fair value. We have a property that was constructed in several stages with various quality of construction. There's probably some environmental risk there, and we have needs that the community is not even aware of yet, and the town council is not even aware of yet. I think purchasing this project for $560 is probably going to be about a third of the cost. Renovation is probably around $750. $60 a square foot, including a lot of site improvements to make parking and the traffic patterns work. If I was in your position, and I think in the best interest of the town, I would think that you would either table the purchase or extend your purchase option until you can have an engineering study done at the building, develop a budget for the renovations so the town really knows what they're buying rather than 560, and you can do an environmental assessment to determine what hazard may or may not be there. That may take 3 to 6 months, but I think that's a better investment than buying a property for 560 and incurring additional debt, which increases our taxes. So I think in the best interest of the town, there's probably a need for community services. I hear all the comments about we never have enough space and they don't work, but every year we seem to buy some. And I certainly would like to have all those additions to my house for a library and a skateboard and things like that. I just can't afford it, and I'm not sure this town can continue to afford it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, my name is George Garnier, and I just happen to be the person. Here on my left, the Murray family that I've worked for almost 40 years. Zelmer and Wayne right there, and their dad's gone. We've had our ups and downs. In spite of that, we built that into that millwork company into a $5.5 million business. It's the largest just about there is in the state of Maine and even in New Hampshire, okay? People in Cape Elizabeth have no idea what goes on there. And I got to tell you that I have done youth work in the church, in the United Methodist Church, for more than 25 years, okay? More than 25 years, I still do it. My first priority has always been the children. God tells us that in the Bible. We all know that, okay? We all know that. The children are first. They come first, and we take care of our children first. I have no animosity or no bad feelings at all about these children who have come up here, these teenage people that come up here and are excited about seeing and trying to get something new and something different going in town. I think that's a good idea. I don't see anything wrong with that, and I wholeheartedly support that. But I gotta tell you that Don Perkins was correct, okay? And if I had gone along with Wayne's proposal, I would either own the building or I would be leasing the building right now, and you people would be right where you are right now, and what would you do? You'd be looking for something else, okay? Because I'd own the building, or I would have had a lease on it as of September 1st, all right? You have it on the books for $344, 2.5 years ago, when he refinanced, okay, it was valued at $435, okay. Now we're gonna pay $560. I never said that I would not pay, okay. I said prove it to me. I never saw the estimate. I was informed of the price by Michael McGovern sitting right over there, and him and Penny Carson, your chairperson, thought it was a good idea. I called them and they ramrodded it through. Okay? That's what I was told by him. Now, Michael told me that. Penny told me, well, that's business. They've been friends, and I'm Henry and other people. And there's been a lot of people up here talking tonight that don't come from this town. Okay? And haven't been around here as long as I have, and certainly not as long as the Murrays have. And we have new ideas and new things, and we're changing, and we're in the 21st century, and we need to do that, and we need to take care of our children, and we have these needs, and we have all these things. I agree with all that, 100%. That's not a problem. But at the same time, are we going to continue? Are you going to continue in this town, all right, to make it so when those children want to raise their family and buy a home here, they're not going to be able to afford to stay here. They're going to have to move out of town. That's what's going to happen. Because the whole town in the center over here, around here, all of the property that you get any taxes at all industrialized, okay, or commercial, 90% of it, or a hell of a lot of it, on this side of town is coming right out of this spot right over here, and we got 20%, 25% of the town living here, and the rest over the other side of town. So where's it coming from? It's like Social Security. It's been 60 years since we started it, and we're still raising the money the same old way and getting 2% on it, and we're in the 21st century. It's time to look somewhere else, okay? I was in Scarborough. I have a paint store over there. They're worried about growth. Everybody's worried about school growth, school growth, school growth. You cannot live next to the Big Apple. When that thing starts to get rotten in the middle, it's going to spread. And you better find a way, okay, to finance your schools and to do the things you got to do. And if you want to keep dipping into people's pockets, these very children that are here now tonight won't be able to afford to live in this community by the time they get through college and get back here. They won't be able to live here, okay? I will go, okay? I will go. I will find another place, and I will survive, and I will go. There's a lot of sentimental value for this place. Believe me, it cost me a lot of money to stay here compared to what I could get a one-story building with loading docks and the forklifts and all those other things. I just didn't stay here all these years, okay, because I was stuck here, okay? I stayed here because this is where C.H. Murray, their father, that's who I started this with. Alma's idea, their father. This is where I started. This is where I wanted to end, okay? I have a second location in Scarborough. I had plans for a second location. We had it. We're in negotiation with somebody. So I could stay here and have this be the number one first place, okay? That's what I planned on. That's why I stayed here. It was not for financial reasons or any other thing, okay? But I will go, and I will hold no grudges against anybody. I'll find something. I'll do something. I've been in this long enough now so that I've been knocked down enough times, got up and got going again, and I'll do it again. And so I just say good luck, and I'm really sorry that you people are so zealous, without much information and all the facts, and rushed around within less than 12 days to beat my offer on a Friday night that expired. That was supposedly not a good enough offer, Wayne. Yet, you rushed around, had a special meeting, and you had a holiday in that week even, in order to put a seal on it. If it wasn't a good offer, I don't understand why you had to bother to go through all that. We could have just gone ahead and just done it any other night, because there wasn't any other buyers in line. There are no other buyers in line at this point. If they are, let them come forward. So I hold, that's what I hold these two over here, okay, responsible for. Because this deal, if I had made it, you guys, none of us would be here tonight. If I had, and I was only trying to be a business person. I have never cheated Wayne Murray or Alma Murray out of one dime. And they, neither one of them could ever stand up here and say that either. And they wouldn't say that, okay? As far as bad blood and all this other stuff, like I said, remember, 35, 40 years we've been together, okay? And when two or three people are together and they always agree, a couple aren't needed, let me tell you.
Thank you very much.
My name is Bethany Roy, and I live at 4 Dyer Pond Road. And I'm really in favor of the town purchasing the building over there, because I think it's such a great opportunity for our town to take advantage of, because we need it for so many different reasons. You know, we need so much more storage and community services. Everything's been mentioned, the teen center, a senior center. And I just think that it would be a really worthwhile investment. I mean, it might take a lot of money to
renovate.
Sorry. But I think that it's just a really worthwhile investment, and so many other towns have centers like this, and I think it would be really nice for our community to have that feature. So
I think that you should really consider buying it because it would be really worthwhile. And this building over here, people have been saying that it's another alternative, but I think it's too small. This building is the right size. I think it's just perfect for what we need. So I think that it would be really worthwhile.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Kaylee Skopinski, and I live on 6 Avon Road. I'm an 8th grader at Cape Elizabeth Middle School, and I think one issue that hasn't been addressed is loitering. Last year, it was a huge problem, and I know policemen were getting very fed up with people loitering around Cumberland Farms, and it eventually got to the point where the Cumberland Farms workers would only allow 5 teenagers at a time to enter it. And I think that's ridiculous that we had to go that low, that it finally came to that point where they were setting limits on how many teenagers could enter. And but there was no place for teens to go. I mean, of course, there's the library, and that's a public place, but there really was no other place. So I think this would be a good place for teens to congregate and be able to get together, and not just teens, senior citizens or community service. I know that even if this isn't the right building, I think there is a necessity for this. And one proposition was that maybe there could be a membership deal, like if a teen wanted to use it, they could pay a certain fee, just like $10 or $15. And say if 400 people, teens used it, that would be $4,000 right there. And I know that's not a lot compared to taxes or compared to what the final cost would be, but everything helps, and I think that's a good proposition to consider. So when you're considering this, I don't know if this is the right building due to environmental hazards or some other issues that people have brought up. But I know that this does have a good location, and the other building was too small. It didn't meet some of the codes that were proposed a couple of years ago. When I was in sixth grade, I remember taking a poll to see, and it didn't pass. So I think that it would be a waste not to take this into consideration when it seems perfect. Thank you.
Thank you.
Madam Chairman, could I come back for a second round if I do not repeat anything that's been said or that I've said?
Yes.
I can wait, Bill.
I think maybe he can. Other people have to speak first, and then you can come back.
Thank you.
There's somebody new, I think.
My name is Sal Scaglione. I'm a resident of Cape Elizabeth. I don't really know all the particulars of this project. I saw a little blurb in the Cape Courier. I work 7 days a week. I own my own business. That's why I just saw this on TV tonight, came over here, because I had almost forgotten about this. I've owned my own business for 30 years. I work 80 to 100 hours a week. I pay a lot of taxes on my house. I saw the little article about this property. And the first thing I thought was, we need to pull in the reins here. I think this town is getting really out of control. I don't know about the rest of the people here. I have no idea who spoke here before me. I work hard for my money. I want to keep my house. I want to be able to live in it till I'm an old man, older man. And at this rate, I don't think I'm going to see it. The taxes keep going up and up and up. Now, this is really nice to hear young people say, I want a place to go, I want a place to go. Well, they can go to other people's houses and gather. 50 years ago, when I was a little kid, I went to other people's houses and gathered and played games and did all sorts of things at their houses. You didn't need a community center. We didn't have one. We lived in a poor community. I'm fortunate enough to live here now. I think this is an incredible burden to put on citizens of Cape Elizabeth to buy still another property and invest all of this money in renovations. Because whatever it is that you come up with for an estimate, I can tell you, it's going to be 3 times the amount. I've been involved in enough projects myself to know that. The other thing that I find disturbing, and again, I don't know all the details, this gentleman who is renting this space right now, this is another property that's on the tax roster right now. The town of Cape Elizabeth buys it and takes it off the roster. What does that mean? It means everybody's taxes have to go up. I'm tired of it. I'm really tired of it. I don't think we need any more things to take care of. Everything needs to be paid for. Maintenance here and maintenance there. We all know what the costs of this are. I think the place should go on the market. This man should be able to buy it, keep it in the tax rosters as it is. And as far as Cumberland Farms, I don't really care about this whole story about Cumberland Farms. It's the first time hearing of this. People, children can go to other homes. They don't need to have a million-dollar center to go and congregate. I think it's outrageous. I think the town needs to remember that it's supposed to be an administrative organization. And when it got into the business of real estate purchasing and investment, it's beyond me. But I think it's out of control. If it were up to me, I'd say, forget it. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Gerald Sherry, 19 Starboard Drive, and I am new in town. What I am hearing about the piece of property, the council may call it a renovation. This is no renovation. I believe if you're going to purchase the building, the best use you could put it to will be to empty it, turn off the power, the water, empty the oil tank, offer it to the fire department, or practice. And that will be the best use of that building as it is. Because I have heard nothing about that building, about renovating it. You're talking better than better than $500,000 to buy it. When you are done with the fire department's practice and get environmental protection in, and when you are done digging down probably 6 to 10 feet, depending on where bedrock is, and refilling it without knowing figures, figure $500,000. So you've now got $1 million invested in a lot. Great start. The suggestions I've heard are the $2 million. So now we've got $3 million invested in a building that you are proposing to put teenagers in, the community center in, for adults, for older people. You're going to find three or four more things to put in there. People, I worked with teenagers for 20-odd years. I taught 9, 10, 11, and 12th grade. It isn't going to wash. You have buildings, school buildings here that are one and a half, two stories high. Check your engineering drawings. It's a lot cheaper to go up one story. The high school I went to was 3 stories high. The elementary school I went to was 3 stories high plus a basement. It didn't kill me to walk up and down stairs. It didn't kill any of the people I went to school with. Our community center was each other's houses. It didn't hurt any of them. We came from a nice town. Every bit as nice as Cape Elizabeth. That's one reason we moved here. We came from the town of West Hartford, Connecticut, who taxes and taxes and taxes themselves out of residents that have all moved to Avon, Simsbury, West Simsbury, New Hartford, Park Hampstead. And this is all commuting distance to Hartford, which, like downtown Portland, is losing businesses, has lost large businesses. And where's this town going to be 5 or 8 years ago from now, when some of the more affluent people who own houses here can't pay the taxes? The bank isn't going to pay them because they got to take and keep supporting the house. You own property, you don't want to raise the height of your schools? Don't. You want a nice little building back here? Enlarge it. You own a building next door, I understand, a gas station, one side or the other, I don't know. How about knocking it down? Building your building there. Don't buy a project for the fire department to practice on.
Thank you very much. I see that there are three people who are now waiting who have been here before, and where it is our practice in public hearings to wait until everybody new has spoken. If you could limit your comments to 1 minute, I will entertain you to finish. There may be a couple of more people. Go ahead.
Okay, I'm Pam Hathaker. I've been up here again. And I've heard many of the arguments that have been presented. And frankly, I disagree. People are saying, we're asking, pretty much, this is what I hear, we're asking for a $2 million country club. Really, all we're asking for is like donations. We just want to go somewhere where we won't be yelled at, where we can hang out and not have to worry about keeping it a low whisper. And really, I've heard many of the arguments, and I can't say I disagree strongly, but I think they should really consider more of their elements. Like, what I hear is, oh, well, we don't have this type of money to spend, but if you think about it in the long run, it's not that much if you get, like, the community to bring stuff in, like use donations.
Great, thank you.
My name is Rob Moriarty. I live at 23 Phillip Road. I've been up here before. And basically, from some of the things I've heard, I'm appalled at some of them, because people are saying that we should just go to our friends' houses and hang out. Well, most kids, when they get home, their parents are not home, and they're not allowed to have friends over to hang out. And if we don't have another place to go besides that, then what are we supposed to do? Go home and sit on the couch, eat food, and watch TV until it's time for dinner, do our homework, go to bed. Kind of boring. If we had a place to hang out, then, I don't know, be a lot more fun, have more things to do, keep us active instead of just going home every day. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Rosemary Reed, real quickly. The other points that I didn't get a chance to mention were, I just wanted to remind the town council, although it doesn't take much reminding, that people in this community donate over $30,000 a year to the bottle shed for the youth of town, that the in-kind donations for people for building fields for the boosters groups and whatever are excessive. When I say excessive, I mean for most communities. People ask me all the time, how can we do in our town what you do in Cape Elizabeth with the bottle shed? I tell them, you can't. You don't have the volunteers. We do what the parents committed to that. So I really think for those people who are scared to death of the price tag for this, that you might look at the revenue aspects. Also, members of the town council know that I've been involved in successful fundraising events for the town. I would volunteer on the record to help get some money for this project to make it go. Also, I wanted to offer up the town report, which I know that Debbie probably has on that computer, but just in case anybody wants to look at it. And the last thing I'll say, at 5 o'clock tonight, my daughter went to the fitness center and pool to sign up, and she is their newest member. And it's because when she went there, she had been shopping around, wasn't sure she wanted to go to the new facility in Cape, wanted to go to a private club. After looking at the price, her comment was, "Mom, the whole family can be there for what it costs for me in Scarborough." So I just think that sometimes people make statements that aren't necessarily totally accurate, and the rates are published for reference.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Hi, my name is Diane Nicholson. I live at 243 Mitchell Road. I don't really have anything to say, but I do want to say that I did grow up in this town. I do live here now and raise my family here. My husband grew up in this town. We're proud to be a part of this town. I think people are, there's a lot of focus on the teen center. That's a very small part of this project that needs to be just said. It's a community center for the community. The reason people move to this town is because of the schools, because it's a nice town to live in, because it's safe for our kids. It's a community center. You can't place it behind Town Hall, because that would mean children would have to cross Route 77. I would not let my children leave school and cross 77 to go to a teen center or a community services program across 77 without being supervised. I wouldn't do it. Kids get hit by cars, maybe not in our town, but when you start trooping them across 77, it's bound to happen. There's been a lot of talk about all these different sites. I don't know. I would assume that as the town council, you have looked at them. If you haven't, I urge you to look at them again. I do, however, support you buying this building. From what I hear, the man who's renting it isn't going to be there anyway. That's what I'm hearing. That's what he said. He's going to go. So why not the town buy it? I understand the tax thing and taxes going up. I know I live in this town. I've lived in this town my whole life. But the people who want to live in this town will live in this town and pay the taxes. Thank you. And I'm sorry you have this decision to make.
Thank you.
Thank you for allowing me the second opportunity. Again, my name is Peter Carter. I reside at 21 Ocean House Road. This time around, I will speak only as an individual member of the planning board. A number of years ago, with the help of the Conservation Commission, this town council, membership from the town appointed by this town council at large and the planning board, we rewrote and came up with the town center zone plan. Basically, this allowed for a well-balanced mixture of residential, municipal, and commercial development within the town center zone. Townspeople supported it. We had numerous public hearings. This council enacted it. Since that time, we have built a new elementary school, a new middle school, a new police station, a new fire station, a new pool. We have built about $21 million of municipal-owned buildings. We haven't built anything else. The town center zone plan is a joke as it stands today. I also believe I'm not crying wolf that a trend has been established. If it's not slowed down, I believe it's very conceivable that this town will buy the Pond Cove Shopping Center and build a new town hall. Thank you.
Patrick, after you, I'm very sorry. I thought I was doing a favor by allowing a couple of people to speak a second time. It is unusual. We do not do that. I will have to stop it. We have several items on the agenda. Not to stop the public hearing, but to stop return visits after Patrick.
Sorry, Mrs. Carson. I've lived in this town since kindergarten, now 24 years old, full-time employee. I make fairly good money. I can't live in this town right now. I can't buy a house because I can only swing the mortgage payment. I can't swing the taxes in this town. And every time it goes up, it makes me feel, why am I still living at home? I can move out of Cape, own a house, get some tax benefits for myself, and still, I think, get the same services. I love this town. I coach football in this town. I help a lot of different organizations. I'm on the fire department and the rescue. I wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning because someone's having a heart attack. But I can't buy a house in this town because town councilors, the town, in the past have kept passing these bond issues, and every single time, like gentlemen said before, tax rate goes up. Every time tax rate goes up, every year when I look at this fiscal budget, and I see, whoops, went up again. I go, do I really want to buy a house in this town? Because what's it going to be in 20 years? Because it goes up every single year. We just spend and spend and spend and spend. We have to stop somewhere. I urge you to stop now. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Sue Pierce, 74 Hunts Point Road. I'm a business owner and a parent of four small children. I've lived in this town for 10 years, and I support the town buying the building that we're talking about. It's my understanding that community services serves the community as a whole. It is a tremendous asset to Cape Elizabeth, and it now will need a home. The school systems need that space, so community services will be misplaced. They've been misplaced numerous times over the last 10 to 15 years, and they do serve the community. I think the location is ideal, being close to the schools, and I would like to give the town council more credit that you have looked at this and would not be considering it if it was going to be a project for the fire department. I believe that you probably have looked at renovations, you have looked at cost, and this decision is not being taken lightly, and the town is not trying to kick a small business out of the town of Cape Elizabeth. And I support you buying the building.
Thank you, thank you.
Good evening. Andy Strout, 30 Fowler Road. I'd like to just say ditto, if I could. But one other thing on top of that is I'm a teacher here, and I'm a coach in the community. I've been here all my life. And one of the things is I'm an advocate for the kids, and I've been very, very involved with the kids here in the community for years, and they need a place to go. I've been involved with tragic accidents in this community. I've been involved in just about everything, and the kids need a place to go. I was on the study committee. I've done surveys with my kids in the middle school that just show that they're looking for places to go and things to do. They need a place to hang out. They need a place to go together. They need a place just to call kind of like their own, without a mom and dad upstairs or without some people overlooking over their shoulders all the time. And a place like this would really lend a great resource to the community with all the other things that are thought about within this property. And I think that this is a real need for us. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good evening. Betty Crane. I have Waven Road. My reason for being here tonight, leaving home rather than watching Al Gore speak at 9 o'clock, is twofold. Primarily, I feel really kind of bad that the town of Cape Elizabeth, in perhaps not a direct way, but an indirect way, is causing a businessman who has been such a loyal supporter of all things in Cape Elizabeth for so many years to have to move. I really feel bad about that. Secondly, I know the teens and I know the seniors need a place. We have a community center which I occasionally visit, like once a week, because I've been taking care of the plants for like whenever the community center opened 8-10 years ago. It is not utilized as much as it should be. Now, Sue Weatherman may disagree with me on this, but I would wager if you drive by the community center any evening, there will be very few lights on. I think we could possibly build on to the community center. There's a big backyard. I believe the town owns behind the dumpsters out back of the parking lot. I don't know whether this is possible, but I would urge the town to look at other alternatives rather than buy this building. As far as taxes go, I haven't gone into that. I kind of agree with Randy Blake that maybe they're going, you know, this is too big an expenditure, not knowing what we're getting into. I would just urge the town to take a little time and look at other alternatives besides this building. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Wayne Murray. For those of you who don't know me, I am the present owner of the property in discussion, the villain, if you want to call it that. This whole item was not the town's fault. I want everybody to understand that. The town did not make any deals or anything else. This whole episode was started by George Gagnon and nobody else. His lease expired August 31st this year. We notified him last winter when he was on the lease. It required him to do so to notify us whether he was going to renew the lease. He informed my wife and I that he was not going to renew the lease and he was going to buy the property. Well, at that time we informed him the property was not for sale. Well, it's going to have to be because I'm not going to sign a lease. And anyway, it went on with a few telephone discussions. We did send him a letter in February notifying that he hasn't notified us of his intention, so we assume he's not going to, this was official. He did send us a letter back stating that he would take a one-year lease, which we weren't interested in a one-year lease. Naturally, anybody that's in the commercial real estate realizes a one-year lease is not something you can take. So this went on for the rest of the year, contacting him back and forth and discussing him with him, and he offered a price which was considerably lower than this price we're talking about tonight. We told him that wasn't satisfactory, and I told him that, you know, that we wouldn't accept that, and the only thing, he'd have to sign a new lease, and he said, no, I'm not going to sign a new lease. I said, well, what are you going to do? And he said, I'm going to stay right here. And we said, well, you know, you can't do that. And he said, well, you'll have to evict me then. So this is the type of attitude we've had trying to work with him over the past year, and it has continually got worse. Now, we've tried to be reasonable, and even after that point, I tried to deal with him, and he would not dicker. So anyway, in August, we had an appraisal done on the property, which is the appraisal of the price you're working on now, and we sent him a letter to that effect, and we even offered the building, the property to him at less than that price because of our relationship and so forth with him. And the minute he got the letter, he called back and talked to my wife, and he said, absolutely not, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that at all. That's a ridiculous price. So at that point, in that letter, it stated that this is our lowest price, and as of August 31st, there would be no more dickering. That was a firm price. So that was it. We were done dickering at that point. We were done negotiating. As far as I was concerned, we made no more contact as far as prices are concerned after September 1st. Somewhere late in September, I think it was 26, 27th, something like that, I had started to contact other people, and I was negotiating with another real estate agent in reference to not selling the property but dickering with him on a future proposal to work between the two of us. Anyway, I happened to stop up to the planning board's office upstairs, not the planning board, but the planning director upstairs, Mrs. O'Meara. I had an appointment with her to discuss the town center plan and what I could possibly do with the building, because I was not familiar with the town center where it was a new item on the ordinance. So I did talk with her, and when I left with her office, I hadn't seen Mr. McGovern, which is a friend of mine, I'll admit. I hadn't seen him in some time, so I simply just dropped in as a cordial visit. So he, in the discussion, asked me what I was doing there, and I told him that I just in to see the planning director because I was trying to see what to do with the property, whether to try to lease it or possibly sell it. And he said at that time, well, if you're interested in selling it, the town might possibly be interested. They need more room, and we're in the process of a discussion with facilities, property, and so forth. So I told him, well, fine, look into it. So a few days later, I met with him and Chairman Carson. And at that point, I did give them a 30-day option, a verbal option, for them to have time enough to get together with the council and to decide whether they wanted to purchase an option, so I would hold it until they could go through this procedure we're doing tonight, and which they did, as you know. So that's where we stand. As far as anything being sneaky, there was nothing sneaky on my part, and I don't think there was anything to do with the council. It was all above board. And The only problem I have with what has happened that has upset me is that his attitude, Mr. Geiman's attitude, has been just terrible. The council faced it twice. They know what he said. And he even kicked me out of my own property. Now, that's a pretty good deal. But I don't understand why he did these things, because he had all the opportunity in the world to purchase this property. But he was bound and determined that his price was the right price. And unfortunately, it isn't. Now, I will say about Mr. Gagnon, the man is an intelligent man. He is a very good businessman. I worked with him for years and had a good relationship. But the last few years, his attitude, as far as with me anyway, has changed considerably. He obviously resented the attitude that I owned the property and that he was had to pay me rent. I sold him the property originally in 85, I think it was. And at that point, he had no financing, and he was a workman. He didn't have any capital. So knowing that his ability, I held a mortgage with no down payment or thing, so that he could own the property. With the understanding, after the property is purchased, then I would get 10 years lease at the regular lease price to get back, because during the purchase price, we kept the lease price down so he could afford to make the payments. And this was understood. Well, he was supposed to take up another 5-year lease in August, and he didn't. And this has been a real bone with him. He has been real upset, because I won't negotiate with that because we had an agreement and he backed down on it. So I'm just saying that he is a smart man, but I'm afraid he's letting his ego get in front of him. Now, as far as the building, I'm not going to get involved in whether the town needs the building or anything else. But I've heard a number of discussions about the condition of the building, the shape of the building, and some of the things that are wrong with it. Now, one of the things that just came up a few minutes ago was lead paint. No question, there probably is some lead paint in the front part of the house. There probably is none inside the barn. Some of the outside trim on the barn might have lead paint. But the newer part of the building, which is the major part of the whole building, I don't believe has any lead paint at all. I know it doesn't have any asbestos. So, and as far as the pollution on the property that the gentleman mentioned, I don't know of any pollution on that property at all. There's no reason for any pollution on that property. There hasn't been anything done there that would create that. The existing buildings I've heard that are ramshackle, they're somebody discussed them, but they're temporary buildings. That building's well over 100 years old. I wouldn't call that temporary. The rear buildings were all built recently according to code. All those buildings that have been additions have all been built since the 70s, early 70s, run up through. Sure, they're additions, but they're all attached to each other. They're done in the right way, and if you look at them, you can't hardly tell the difference between one building and the other. And the buildings are structurally sound. Now, the only thing I got to say about the buildings is the town does have an engineering survey on the building, and I'm sure that they have that available, and I don't know of any problems with that engineering survey. George mentioned sentimental value in the property. I don't doubt that he probably has. I have too. In fact, I probably have a little more than him, because the first year my wife and I were married, we lived for 3 years in that second floor apartment. So a little sentimental value about there with us too. And I've heard that other people say that, about discussions of lived here for so many years, worked here so many years. I'm not a stranger to Cape Elizabeth. Most of you don't know me, I'll admit. But I've lived in Cape Elizabeth a good number of years. I volunteered about 40 years of my life to the town of Cape Elizabeth in the fire department. I was chief of the fire department. I was on the planning board. I was a 5-year member of the town council. So I don't think that I have anything to be ashamed about as being a former resident. I'm not a resident now, I'll admit. But I did do my duty for the town of Cape Elizabeth. But if you have any more questions, I'd be more than glad to answer them.
Thank you. There may be some questions for several people from the council when we finish the public hearing.
Jim Murray, 21 Shipwreck Cove Road. Plain, I'm not sure, one of the two.
Back, fight me. First of all, I've got great respect for Wayne, who was a second cousin, and George Gagne, who was a fellow businessman that we have both done work for, and I've got great respect for both. As far as the teens go, I was one myself in 52 and 53, along with Madam Chairman, who was in the same town, and I believe our teen center was Nelson Packham's drugstore.
You're much younger.
Or the donut hole in Great Pond, one of the two. But I just would like to say a couple things. I think we need a little laugh here, so that's half the reason why I got up. But I would like to say one thing.
Thank you, Jimmy.
The town should take a look, and I don't blame Wayne for selling the business because it's a headache. But I don't think the town should be buying any more businesses in the town of Cape Elizabeth. We've taken two off from the center of the town right now, the Urban Station, the old barn behind. If the attorney, judge's attorney, Don Perkins, is correct with his numbers, I think we should really take a look at what's happened with the business. I don't know whether Wayne has offered it to the business next door, or whether that's been discussed, but I hate to see, as a businessman, 45 years in this town myself, any more go. Thank you.
These are student representatives to the town council.
My name is Kristen Elia. I live at 6 Meadowview Lane. And the other week, I had the opportunity to go into the building with the town council and just look around. And I think that purchasing this building would be really a great opportunity for the town, as everybody has said. But if you haven't had the chance to go in there, the possibilities are absolutely limitless as to what we could do in there as a town. And I know for years it's been an issue of having everybody settled as far as high schoolers being in an environment where they belong and middle schoolers being in an environment where they belong and the kindergartners being in Pond Cove. And I think that purchasing this building would be a perfect opportunity to have everybody settled down where they belong in an environment where they can really flourish as students, and having community services be right there in the thick of it where they belong, because they take such a big part in everything that goes on in the school and in the community as a whole, obviously. And the tax issue, there's going to be things that are going to raise taxes in this town for years to come. And in the long run, I think purchasing this building, even though it will increase taxes maybe, is going to be beneficial. I mean, you can't stop things like that from happening no matter what the town purchases. They see them as they come, and if it's a good thing, I think they should do it, and this is a good thing for the town in the long run. And Jamie and I are seniors at CAPE now, and we've gone through the middle school, and I mean, we're both on SAC, and I know Jamie's going to address that, and we visit CAPE in the Community Service Center, and it's just ridiculous the size, how small it is. We couldn't even fit in there with 30 kids. So it's important that you take it all into consideration, and I know you have obviously looked at these other options and whatnot, but speaking as a student here in the town who's gone through most of the school's systems, it'd be really beneficial, I think.
Thank you.
And my name is Jamie Clucci, and I live at 9 Birch Knolls, and I just wanted to say everything that Kristen said, and that, first of all, like she was saying with the community center that we have right now, our SAC met there in the beginning of this year, and there were kids sitting on the stairs and leaning in through windows to hear, because there just wasn't room. And the other thing is that no matter what people say, kids can go to homes, they can read books. Kids do read books, and kids do go to homes, but there is nowhere in this town that kids can go and just be with themselves. There have been many times where I've been out with friends walking around wanting to look at the stars, and we can't even go into Fort Williams, which is understandable because we want to avoid parties and we want to avoid vandalism, but there needs to be a place for kids to be kids and kids to be on their own. And I think that's something that's very important and something that needs to be addressed. Whether people say you can go to homes or not, that's not the same situation. And it's not the same trust being given to the kids.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I'm sorry, I can't let that opportunity go by.
George, like the other second time, can you just limit it to short
time?
Yes,
I will.
Thank you.
If any of the lay people in the audience, well, I've had two or three of them come down that have asked to walk through the building. You're welcome to call me and walk through the building and see what you are buying, okay? And what Wayne just said is more of what I said. 30 years, 40 years together, him and Elmer are sitting right there, okay? And what he's saying right now is I could air dirty laundry and I could do that whole thing. And believe me, I'm a very honorable person. I have a very good reputation in this town. And I'm not bragging. And I have a very good reputation in the whole of the Northeast, okay? And I can prove it. I don't have to prove it. I don't know too many people personally. A few I don't anyway on this council right here. But I think that the slinging of the mud and not getting along and all that is something that we shouldn't be talking about here. That's what I meant when I said when there's more than three people and they can't get along, you know, they aren't needed, okay? Believe me, I am a good businessman, and he benefited it, the community, and we all benefited the family and everybody from it, okay? And we must understand that. I'm not a deadbeat, and I'm not hard to get along with. I'm a successful business person, okay? That's what I am. And he is not.
Seeing nobody standing there, I will declare this public hearing closed. It's time now for the council to have their discussion, and it is also time for the council to be able to have any questions that they have to any specific people in the audience to have the opportunity to ask it. There are a couple of things before we launch into a discussion. I'm going to ask the manager to speak on something, but I wanted to say a couple of things that one of the things I let off with is that we're not making this decision in isolation. We're not out there saying, oh, look around, let's look around for a building to buy. This is like a domino. This is part of several decisions that are going on within the community, and we as policymakers need to look at a lot of different things. One of the things that we're guided by is our comprehensive plan, and in turn, in this particular part of the town, we're guided by the town center plan. Town Center Plan, published in 1993 by a group of citizens supported by staff. There are a couple of things, for instance, that guide us in the decisions that we make. In the Town Center Plan, the goal for the Town Center is to increase the sense of community. Schools are an appropriate village-oriented use which contributes vitality to a town center. The school campus and municipal buildings in the town center clearly contribute to the town's vitality and community pride. It is our job in the town center to encourage preservation and enhancement of locally historic buildings. We will not be burning this building down if we own this building. We are to encourage uses targeted to residents. The town council itself also writes each year goals for itself as part of their guidelines. Number four on our list of goals this year was to work with the school department and the community services and staff to continue planning for enhancement of our facilities for uses by senior citizens and youth. So when this building came before us, these are some of the things that we considered in the process of making our decision. We at no time came between the seller and the tenant. That's their business. The seller came to us. We don't know what went on between them. Doesn't have anything to do. We are simply acting on the offer that came before us. So I wanted to tell you that we do not make our decisions in isolation. I do not know how this decision is going to go tonight, but I do know that we have been provided with a great deal of material. We are not completely blind to the material that's been presented to us. We have a fair appraisal, which I'll ask the council, the manager, to respond to. And we also have a study of the building done by SMRT, Architectural Engineering and Planning, which is talking about space needs in the community, and specifically looked at this building and gave us a fairly lengthy, 14-page report on the status of the building, the condition of the building, the potential space uses of the building, and so that is part of our decision-making process as well. I will ask the manager to speak for a moment on the appraisal.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I wanted to go beyond just the appraisal for a minute. And there's been a lot of comments made of what the town's looked at and what the town hasn't, and the fact that, you know, maybe we're doing this independently and rashly even considering it. There has in fact been only one appraisal done. It was an appraisal done of a person that was originally hired by the owner of the property. However, it was done by an independent firm by the name of Tobias Appraisal Services Incorporated, Ines Philip Tobias, who holds many different certifications on appraisal, including an MAI designation, which is for appraisers who are experienced, quote, in the valuation of commercial, industrial, residential, and other types of property. He also is a past president of the Maine State Chapter of the Appraisal Institute in 1997. He served in that capacity. He's a member of the Appraisal Institute. He's a certified general appraiser holding a current state of Maine license. He's a certified Maine assessor, and he's also served for 5 years as the chairman of the City of Portland's Board of Assessment Review. He's a man with very distinguished qualifications, and the report that he provided that the town has a copy of, I would guess, is approximately 100 pages. This is all a summary of this. Not the full report was all made available to the town council looking at different properties. This was also reviewed by the town's assessor to see if it followed generally acceptable principles. He found that it did, although our assessor did not do an independent appraisal in addition to this. But, you know, this is an appraiser who is independent of the town. Yes, he was hired by the owner of the property, but he certainly has the certifications and the qualifications that we have become accustomed to over the years and expecting from an independent certified review appraiser. Secondly, there's been a lot of mention that the town has not had anyone independent look at the building and it might have to be torn down and some of those issues. Mrs. Carson mentioned that we had the firm SMRT look at it. For those that are unfamiliar with SMRT, it used to be called Stevens, Morton, Rose, and Thompson. It's a descendant of the original John Calvin Stevens, one of the most famous architectural firms in this area of the world. SMRT, we contracted to go look at the building. They sent through the building a structural engineer, a mechanical engineer, electrical engineers, cost consultant, as well as an architect, all looking at the building. As Penny mentioned, they gave us about a 15-page report. It does provide for a spring 2001 cost estimate, when we wouldn't be proposing to do the work, to renovate the building, including all of the issues that they found that in some way were in some way deficient, of $894,000. However, with contingencies, administrative fees, design fees, the estimate increased to $1.192 million, or $64 per square foot. And a copy of that report is available if anyone would like to see it. The community center was also mentioned as something that was possibly the current community center over at 1226 Shore Road, as something possibly expandable. Last year, under the leadership of Councilor Ruth Watson, the Community Center Committee met, of which a couple of members spoke this evening, Catherine Miller and Andy Strout. And Mark Wilcox, who's an architect, looked at that building and reviewed it and essentially found that it was not feasible for expansion or for a minor renovation. And that's why, essentially, that committee got stopped in its tracks, because there didn't seem to be another building available. About 5 years ago, Mr. Murray had come in to see me to see if the building might be of interest to the town. At that point, I indicated no. I think I reviewed it, you know, with several of the councilors at the time. And the reason that was different this time is that we did know that community services was going to be have to be leaving the middle school space that they now have at some near point in the future. And that's why it did become something worthwhile looking at. There's all sorts of tax projections. I'll wait until there's questions on that. But the town has looked extensively at the tax impact of this project in relation to major tax increases. And would you like me to answer that, or would you want me to?
Go ahead. Do you think we should wait? Does the council want to get into their debate first before we get into the tax?
No, go ahead.
The town has a number of areas of what we call debt service, repayment of debt. And if you'll excuse my laptop, a lot of the information is right here.
Kids are leaving.
I don't want to hear these numbers.
You don't want to hear this numbers from kids?
The town has debt service. Debt service is made up of two components, principal and interest. The way all the town's debt service is set up is that we essentially have level principal payments, which means that the interest goes down each year. As a result of that, our cost goes down each year in other debt services out there. We've looked at all of our debt service when it's expiring. We've looked at our valuation. We've looked at not only this project, but all of the other three items that are on the town council agenda this evening. The renovation of Public Works Garage into a town center fire station, a new police station where the current public safety building is now located, $150,000 contribution from a bond for land acquisition, as well as $150,000 playground improvements. Add it all together, that increases the tax rate by 3 cents this coming year, out of a tax rate of $20.30. This is for the borrowing portion. That's not to say that there might not be some additional heating costs and custodial costs. The debt service portion increases 3 cents. In the following year, it increases an additional penny. And some of you, it was in a part of the packet that there were about 20 of them on the back table. Beyond that, it begins to decrease every year by 10 cents in the third year, and then down eventually over the 20 years so that all the debt service costs would ultimately be eliminated. What that shows is for a 3 cent increase at this point, by the time the renovation cost came up of somewhere in the vicinity of $1 million, that what we'd be looking at is essentially being able to pay for those renovations by the fact that other debt is going down, the interest cost every year, paying off principal every year, as well as the rent the community services is now paying in the fees. So what we're looking at to purchase this building, to do all those other projects I mentioned, and to renovate this building at $1 million, and I agree it's too early to say exactly how much that cost is going to be. That's a very preliminary estimate. We're looking at essentially flat taxes beyond because of other decrease. Some could argue, well, if you weren't doing all this stuff, maybe taxes would go down. I agree that can be argued. But it does show that all of this can be done, and all these projections are available, as I mentioned, as copies, for 3 cents this coming year, an additional penny the year after, and then it'll decline thereafter. And this is on a current tax rate of $20.30. You can see it doesn't compare to the percentages we're looking at on the national news in terms of differences, but it is a relatively small percentage. Thank you.
Could I ask a question?
Yes.
So is what you're saying, Michael, or Mr. Manager, that with a 3 cent increase for all these projects, not just the millwork, but 3 cents for all these, to do all these projects that we're talking about tonight, that for, say, a $200,000 home, that'd be like $6 a year?
It'd be $6 a year, correct.
So for $6 a year, a person who owned a $200,000 home could get the police station, the fire station, the millworks building, the land acquisition, and the playground thing, everything we're talking about, assuming we passed all those things.
That's correct.
Okay. I just want to make sure I understood.
Well,
we've already raised their taxes, though, for the fire station, the police station. We did that last year. So this is the additional monies, right?
Everything we're voting on tonight.
No. Is just for the additional money for the...
Not really, because the tax rate for the current year for municipal and county services is 525. And the year before it was 525. So all of that was absorbed by really the council taking a real hard look at revenues and increasing some of the revenue estimates. So all of these projects, you know, with the pool, there was a tax increase the previous year, but in the last year there was absolutely zero increase in municipal and county services, and the projection is for this coming year there would be 3 cents for these projects, which is not to say that there might not be other issues in the budget as well.
I just want to advise you that, you know, I sit on the budget advisory committee for the county, and we're looking at 11% tax increase for the town for the county. So I don't know if you figured that into your...
If I might, Madam Chairman, I have looked at a whole number of issues. I've looked at the county tax, which is a big issue. I've looked at a health insurance impact, and I've also looked at wage increases. And all of that, you know, with proper restraint with all the department heads, it does show that, you know, we probably aren't looking at a zero increase as we look the past few years, but we are looking at a rate increase simply in the municipal 5.25, excluding the school and everything else, of 3%, which would be 15 cents for everything.
What about the school?
We don't know about the school. The school budget hasn't prepared its school board hasn't prepared its budget yet.
Councilor Fritz had comment. Maybe you've forgotten it.
It was really related to, I was thinking that this was 3 cents over what we had budgeted for the public, but okay.
Councilor McClary Watson.
Madam Chair, I'd like to make a couple of observations and then just kind of do a little dialoguing here kind of with myself as I do this as well. As chairman of the study committee for the community center last year, I'm not going to go into what Catherine Miller went into and Sue Weatherby, but they've already discussed what we came up with as a need for a community center. And most of the people sitting on that committee felt, and I think we would have had a unanimous decision, that there was a need in this town for a community center on some scale. Our problem was that we knew we could not bring a renovation to 1226 Shore Road to the council of any large dollar amount because of the facility's 2000 projects. Of close to, and Mike, correct me, but close to $7 million we were looking at between the pool, the new public works, the new fire and police, which we're looking at tonight, and then to then come to the council at that point for the fiscal year 2001-2002 and ask for a $200,000-$400,000 renovation to 1226 Shore Road, we felt that it would never fly. And we felt that we couldn't do that. Number one, a part of the problem was that it was off the campus of the school. And to make that kind of investment off the campus and not an ideal place, we didn't think the council would agree to. And the other thing is we were looking at making a modest renovation to 1226, just to bring everyone up to speed, to the tune of maybe $20,000 to $30,000. And we were going to put a teen center in the basement. Would have to be ADA accessible. We would have had to have tried to figure out a way to get handicapped accessibility in and out of the basement, fire codes, et cetera. That was not feasible because of the height of the ceiling. If we had been able to do that, you would have been looking in this current year's budget of somewhere to the tune of, you know, another $15,000, because we had $15,000 from the study committee to renovate that building. And we'd be looking at opening up a facility that would have blown out some of the walls upstairs, so we could have had a larger senior room, as well as a room where we probably would have moved Paul Gasper out and put in a craft room for seniors where they could have had their crafts there all the time, not have to take them in and out, and could have been left there. And there already was a kitchen, and it would appear that that would have worked well, except to renovate that space just wouldn't work. And so our committee came to a screeching halt because there was no other place at that point for us to look. And we just weren't comfortable as a committee, knowing what we were facing as a town from all of these major projects, of bringing that forward. So that's why that project kind of died on the vine. And I can honestly tell you that prior to this building of the Millworks coming forward, I had not envisioned us looking at a community center anytime in the near future. You know, and we had tried opening up a teen center in the church. That doesn't work. There needs to be dedicated space. We went to South Berwick. We went to York. And we saw senior centers that worked phenomenally well for the community. Karen Allen was there, and who runs our senior program for community services, and Sue. And we spent an entire day on a bus going from one town to another looking at what these towns offered their seniors. They didn't have any teens in them. They were separate facilities for seniors. And actually, we came away somewhat discouraged because these towns didn't have the wherewithal that Cape Elizabeth does in terms of a tax base, and yet they had wonderful facilities for just their seniors. But we just didn't feel that we could take on that project at that time. Number one, there wasn't a facility that was had great accessibility for us and really could do what we wanted it to do. We just didn't feel like we could move forward. So we have to understand that for me to look at this building, the Millworks building, it's a phenomenal opportunity that I thought would never take place in the next, in the immediate future. So for me, I am very torn because this building has the opportunity of providing an awful lot of things that we need in this town, from opening, providing for our seniors, providing a place for our teens, and also being a home for community services, which brings our community together and is a phenomenal group of individuals and people that bring a great deal of value to us as a community. And they return that in terms of revenue and almost being self-supporting. And Sue and her group do a great job with our pool and our new weight facility. And those are just, like, I think, harbingers of things to come when we look at what Sue Weatherby can do if we give her the space and provide her with the opportunity to offer services and the kinds of things we can do for our town. So the Millwork building, is very positive in that regard. The one thing that's great about that the only other place that exists that we could do is to take the parking lot that currently exists by the public library, that at some point we probably need to pave. There's a lot over there. We need to pave and make more parking space for the library. But the only other place in town that's on that side for accessibility of school is that open lot over by the library, which John McGinty has talked about, our building a teen center or senior center over there. That is a possibility. We do have a lot. Now, we will not have enough parking at the library, but we do have a lot that we could use and we could build something on for community services and for our seniors and our teens. It would be much smaller. The scale would not be as grandiose. It would not solve probably the storage issue for the school. But, we could put a Band-Aid on something. But I don't think we want to put a Band-Aid on this project. Now, that's one side of the coin. I'd like to look at the other side of the coin. I think it is extremely unfortunate that we are in the position we're in tonight, and we were in a few weeks ago. I feel extremely badly that we as a town are in the middle of, not our fault, but got involved in a situation between two parties that could not come to terms and could not agree. I think that's unfortunate. I feel badly about that situation for the Murrays. I feel badly for George Gagnon, the Millwork, and all of your employees. It's an unfortunate set of circumstances. If I could have been a negotiator on it, believe me, I would have done everything I could to make sure that you guys came to terms and we weren't having this discussion tonight. But short of that, I don't think there's anything we could have done about that, because it seems to me that stakes were put in the ground early and people weren't going to budge. And I just think that's unfortunate. The only thing I will fault the town on, and I have said this publicly, is that I think we should have waited 24 hours from our first meeting when we sat here and we decided whether or not we were going to put a reservation on this building. I would have liked to have seen Mr. Gagnon's offer expire on the 13th of November and for us to have met at 5 o'clock that evening versus 5 o'clock the previous evening. I think if we can be criticized, we can be criticized for that. I have said that publicly. I say that again tonight. I think that if anyone wants to point a finger at us, they can say we maybe jumped in 24 hours too early. But the reality was that 24 hours probably wouldn't have made a hill of beans difference. That I don't know that they would have come to terms or anything else would have happened. But I do feel badly about that. I wish that had not taken place, because I think that holds us up as maybe looking not as clean as maybe we should. And I think that we have done nothing wrong. I mean, we are in a situation where the town was offered an opportunity to buy a property that's adjacent to our own campus. We would be remiss as a council not to look at that. It's just unfortunate that the deal hadn't died before we got involved. But in the terms of real estate, which is what I do as a business, no deal is done until the ink is signed, the paper signed and it's inked. I mean, and unfortunately that hadn't taken place, and as long as that hasn't taken place, you can negotiate anything. And that's where we found ourselves. And so here we are. I feel badly about it. I cannot begin to tell you how badly I feel about the situation. But I want you to know that I visited the the building. I was unable to go the night that the council went, but George was very gracious, and he allowed me to go through on the 17th, on Friday. He took me through the building. We spent an hour and a half together, and I went through the building. I looked underneath the pillars. Some of them are in this report. I've talked to our manager about it. I have some structural concerns about the building. I was pleased to see that the engineering report addressed some of those structural issues. I had some concerns. There was an underground oil tank that was removed, I think, several years ago. I had some concerns about that. That's not in this report, but I've been told that that is not an issue. I'm holding that up. You know, it's obvious that the roof needs to be redone. The siding needs to be redone. This is a building that has been built onto many times. One of the boilers is very old and needs to be replaced. One of the boilers is 6 years old, and there's not enough air that gets to it, and so there's some mechanical issues to deal with, but I think that it's workable, particularly if you go and renovate the building. I'm not going to go into all the issues that I saw with the building. There are issues. Is it workable? Absolutely. Do we need to burn it down? I don't think so. But the reality is we're going to be talking about money to renovate it. But you have to look at money to renovate a building on top of the cost to buy the building and what that number is, versus the reality is this isn't buy this building or not buy it, spend money or not spend money. The reality is buy this building and renovate that and weigh the costs of that versus waiting for Marie Prager's facility committee to come back to us from the school, which it will next month, and tell us that we have issues in our schools, which we've heard tonight, in Pond Cove, in the middle school. My son is in the seventh grade. He is in that class of 170 students. I know very well firsthand the demands that that student population in the seventh grade puts on the middle school, as well as the fifth grade. And those kids are going into the high school. We have more demands placed on our space requirements in each of our schools because of learning results and the programs we have to put forth because of learning results and because of computers and staffing requirements and special education and ed techs. And I'm not going to go into that. That's a school issue. But we have demands on each one of our school facilities. We're going to have to spend money. We are going to have to move the kindergarten out of the high school. Some might say, well, you're doing it for safety reasons, one, or two, we're doing it because of space reasons. Both are correct. But we're going to have to move the kindergarten out of the high school. They need to go back, in that case, to the Pond Cove facility. We're going to have to juggle students into the middle school and put the larger population into the high school. That puts community services out in the cold. There's no place for them. We have storage issues in the school we have to address. So we're not talking about spending money, some money, or spending no money. We're talking about spending some money to renovate Pond Cove Millworks or spending some money to provide for our school facilities at some point. And it's what's the difference and what's it going to cost us? And in the final analysis, can we buy something that will have a greater utility for us to accomplish all of those needs? Or are we going to address it piecemeal, which we've been doing ever since we started the school renovation? So we can either take a short-term perspective and spend a little money over a period of many years, or in my view, we can look at it as a whole project, a long-term project, hopefully. It may not fix all of the problems. I'm not even going to be able to tell you. I don't have a crystal ball. I can't tell you if we do this building, that we're not going to have any more space issues in the school. I'd never go out on that limb. But at least I'll tell you that I think we can address it on a more long-term perspective than short-term perspective, and I think that the Millworks building allows us to do that. So, and I'm kind of rambling on here, but it's helping get me where I need to be and maybe helping you to understand where I'm coming from. You know, we're looking at spending money. Clearly. I mean, I'm very concerned for Russ Halleck and the Sherrys and the people who come to this town, move into this town and want to live here. The gentleman who came in here is very concerned in the back of the room about his taxes. if anyone will tell you that I'm real, and Manager McGovern will be one of the first ones to tell you, I'm a real stickler when it comes to taxes and saving taxpayer money, and I look at those numbers very closely, I assure you. And, you know, I am very concerned about people being able to afford to live here, because we need a population that's diverse across many economic classes in this town, not just one. So we have a responsibility to represent everybody here. So where I am is I'm trying my best to be a responsible person when it comes to your money. And that's first and foremost to me, is guarding your tax dollars. But part of that is understanding that we're going to have to spend some money and trying to do it in the best, most feasible, economically responsible, fiscally responsible way in the future. And I know that we're going to have to spend money to continue to have a school system in this town that offers the things that we need. So all that being said is, I wish we weren't here, but we're here. And my basic feeling is that, number one, I said this in the very first meeting that we ever had on this subject. If we move forward on any project, whether it be Pine Cove Mill Works or expanding the high school or whatever it is we're doing, we should sell 1226 Shore Road. I've said that before. I would almost make it a prerequisite to doing anything in the future, that if we go into a different building, we sell 1226 Shore Road, we take that money and we invest it, reinvest it in whatever project it is we're going to do. I even went so far as to say I thought we should sell the gas station lot next door, raise money and put that in the coffers to help fund some of this project. That didn't fly so well. So I backed off on that. Well, you know, 50-50 is not bad. So I'll go with my odds of just selling 1226 Shore Road. I think I can probably get people to agree with that. We'll put that money in the coffer. I'll work on the parking lot later. But and then move forward, because where we are is we're not going to come to terms between Mr. Gagnon and Mr. Murray. That's not going to happen. It's not our business to do that. They're not going to do that. If I thought that if we walked away from the deal, that they would come to terms, I would tell you tonight we shouldn't do this. But from every indication I've had, whether we move forward or not, they're not going to do business together. So I would like to see Mr. Gagnon. I talked to him about this when I toured the building. I said, if we move forward on this building, can I implore you to consider staying and keeping and renting the paint store, being our tenant in the paint store? And this was a few weeks ago, but he said he would like to do that. I would like to offer that to him. I can't do it alone, but I would like to offer that. I hope we could get enough concurrence that if he'd be willing to stay and rent from that building at a, you know, rent that's feasible, that we keep him in town, keep his paint business here, although he's going to have to move his millwork business someplace else. So I will support this project. It is with sadness and some regret as to how this has come about, but I will support going forward. Just one other thing, I've looked pretty closely at these numbers, and the number of $1.192 million to renovate only takes into consideration the upper floors. It does not take into consideration the 7,800 square feet that are in the basement. That number of $1.192 million is not a real number in my mind. In my view, by the time we buy the building and by the time we renovate what we need to renovate on the upper and lower levels, we're going to be very close to $2 million. That's my assessment of looking at these numbers. No, I've looked at it pretty closely. I can honestly tell you that, based on my looking at it, it's going to be two. It's not going to be 1.19, another 5.6. I mean, we need to add another 250,000 into that project, in my view, because we're going to have to put an elevator in the basement. because you're going to have to be able to access from the lower and upper levels. That's my feeling. That's my feeling. I mean, I just, that's where we are, and I want to be real honest with where I think we're coming out on this. And we're going to have access from the, you cannot put a teen center in the basement and have no access to the upper floor. You know, we're going to have a elevator. That's going to be about $60,000, $50,000 to $60,000, probably somewhere, some commercial elevator. And I think there's going to have to be some space down there that is going to be some, other than just storage space, I think we may need to expand a little bit more than that. So I hope my numbers are wrong, but I'll go with my numbers. I'm finished. Thank you.
I didn't want to...
I appreciate your patience.
I didn't want to step out there too quick. Councilor McGinty.
Fortunately, Ruth hit on several of the things I was going to say. I agree with her. This report only states that they're renovating the first floor for $1.1 mm-hmm. Million, and I agree with her. And that was if we started in spring 2001. Mm-hmm. We don't even intend to start for another year or so. So additional costs for the renovation of the lower floor. Also, the structural issue, I picked up on that in the report. And I go back to the police station, you know. They told us no problem. We could renovate the police station for $750,000, and now we're going to demolish it and spend $2 million to build a new station. So, you know, I don't trust anything they say until they get in there and actually take a look at what's going on. And that's not a reflection on them. That's the way business is, particularly the structural issue. I think that can be a major one. I have a question or a comment regarding the appraisal. And there were certain assumptions made when this appraisal was made, and it was made that it would be developed for retail, commercial, and or business professional offices. And with the town assessed value of $344,000 and us offering $560,000, $200,000 spread, I wonder if that appraisal would be different if it would be used for municipal purposes as opposed to commercial or retail space. Obviously, someone buying this could look at it to develop it into commercial as opposed to the building being used for a municipal purpose. So I would question the assessment based on that, because that assessment is made with those assumptions made. And also, according to the SMRT preliminary report for the School Facilities Committee, they estimated that we could build from the ground up, we could build a community services building without, not including the site costs and land purchase, although we might be able to find a place to do that. For $1.1 million. So, you know, we're going to spend $1.5 million more than their estimate that we could build, not including land costs, that we could build a community services facility from the ground up. So this is going to be an expensive proposition. You know, we're here now. I had wanted several years ago to do a complete master plan for the town center, including all the public safety buildings and the lot next door in 1226. That didn't fly. So we're here today, as Bruce says, you know, we are where we are now. But I think people need to know, and again, I agree with Ruth, that we may spend $500,000, $560,000 in this building, but 2 years from now or a year and a half from now, we're going to be looking at $2 million to make it into something that we want it to be. So people need to know that a couple of years from now that we're going to be facing that amount of money, in my opinion.
Yeah. I'm not going to disagree with the $2 million figure because I don't want to create a trap for myself 2 or 3 years down the road. But let me just clarify what the estimate's for from SMRT. The scope of work budget, this is quote, the scope of work budgeted includes the renovation of approximately 10,700 square feet at the upper level for community services and other town uses and code and system upgrades to the total 18,500 square feet combined area of upper and lower levels. So it does provide code and system upgrades to the lower level, but it does not provide finished office or space to lower level. That's because it was assumed when they looked at this that the lower level would be primarily used for storage and wouldn't require those more extensive upgrades.
On your other, it also, could I add, it doesn't include any
site work.
Any work on the front portion of the building.
That's correct, Councilor. It also does not include the old house in the front. The other, you asked a question about the appraisal. The appraisals are based on And if the council, I don't think you got, you didn't get the whole big book. It was about 100 pages. Appraisals are based on the uses that are allowed in that particular zone. And with that appraisal, they quote extensively from the town center zone. And that's why it was chosen for that particular purpose, because the appraisal is based on the uses that are permitted in that zone, which are retail, commercial, and whatever else you said, as well as municipal. It has the same appraisal, whether it's municipal, retail, or commercial. It has the appraisal based on the uses in that zone.
Can I ask a question about that?
Yes, Councilman Gibson.
Talking about the appraisal. Did it indicate that he did sales comparison in the, because it's not in our
yes,
part.
It's extensive sales comparison, particularly with other millwork properties. Surprisingly, there have been a number of them sold in just in the last couple of years throughout Greater Bowl.
But nothing.
There isn't any comparables
in the town. Not within Cape itself. Yeah. All right. But it was Wyndham, it was Yarmouth, it looked like every millwork had sold in the last couple of years, the property itself.
Councilor Roberts.
Thank you. I listened carefully to a lot of the comments being made tonight and took them to heart. Some of the points that were made, like potentially purchasing the Tinsman property or renovating and expanding the present community service, our community building over here, really are not an option. I know if we tried to expand 1226 by tearing that down and building something large enough to accommodate what the needs are, or if we try to do something similar with Tom's property, the neighbors on either side are going to go ballistic. It's just not going to happen, whether it's allowed by zone or not. We most of us know the neighbors. There have been court battles in those neighborhoods already over uses that don't go anywhere near what the school's needs are. I do have some concerns about the amount of money that we're talking about on that, and I'm not sure that we have explored all the other options. John had mentioned the $1.1 million for a new building, as opposed to doing the other work. The problem is, where would we put it? And I think the only location might potentially be where the buses are parked, but then they've already got a shortage of parking over there, so I don't. That's really not as much an option as I'd like to think that it might be.
We got the library.
No, I'm not even going to touch the library. Where I am, I guess where I'm at tonight, is that it's a long-term investment if we purchase it. And if we had to put community services into even portable classrooms or something, if the tenant wanted to stay a little bit longer than the 2 years, if he couldn't make a move, I'd even be willing to go that route. I think it would be cost prohibitive. I know it would be cost prohibitive to duplicate the exact amount of space, and we don't have a place to put it anyway. So the manager has clearly detailed where we are debt-wise. I think that we really don't have an option. We're going to wind up spending at one point or another. This seems to work the best. And as has been stated, I hate to see a business go, but that location meets all of the needs of the town and the school. And nobody that I've spoken with has come forward with another location that we could put something on. And tonight I was listening to see if anybody had a viable option. Nobody seems to. And where I'm at tonight is predicated completely on the fact that it's my understanding that this building was not going to be sold to Pond Cove Millworks, that it was going to be put on the open market instead if the town did not exercise their option. I don't think the town can afford to let it go now that we have that opportunity. So I guess I'm coming down on the side of just biting the bullet and doing it.
Councilor Fritz?
Well, this is it's a very difficult decision because we're doing so much work on the buildings in the town, and I certainly would have liked this project to come to us at a different time. But it's an opportunity that really, I think, solves a lot of problems that we have in terms of space. Because I think there really are some serious problems at the schools that are obviously going to take up the space that they have and move community services out. I'm not positive what the timing is. I was hearing a year and a half. I was hearing, you know, shortly. But I think we have time to thoroughly explore the uses for that building. It's certainly not something I see as a teen center. Believe me, it's got many, many uses and provides us with flexibility. I think we could continue to rent the upstairs of the house, and that will provide for itself, and also rent the retail space that's in the house. And I would certainly be flexible for Mr. Gagnon to stay while we're exploring options. I think this building, it's a huge space, it's a huge flexible open space that we can, I think will be cheaper to renovate than to build a new building and additions onto the schools. And I think that's our only choice, really. I think some of the other suggestions that were made for exploring other places just won't work. They really aren't big enough. That's been said already. Again, the location is important because it's near the schools, and for storage, all the athletic equipment, that frees up some space in the school. I think we probably need to sell the Shore Road building. I just don't see why we would need a huge Pond Cove space and that as well. I think community services definitely needs to continue having the programs be covered by the fees that are run in that program, and particularly the cost of the extended school daycare. I don't think that we should be looking for space for that kind. If we have the space and if it actually makes money for the community services programs, I think that's okay. But I don't really think that's a town responsibility or a priority. But I think we also need to keep a close eye on the revenues coming in for this year, because we're getting less in from the state from sales taxes and revenue sharing. So I don't think we can be frivolous, but I will support this. And I think we have to do a lot more exploring of the details. But
thank you. Are any other councilors who wish to speak? Councilor Barry?
I feel uncomfortable about the appraisal because it's assessed for $344,000. I know there's been an explanation, but we're putting a price of $560,000. Why has it been appraised at $344,000? And tonight we've been told that a couple of years ago it was appraised at $435,000 for evaluation that was done at that time. And all of a sudden it's grown to $560,000. I've heard about municipal and business uses not being the same, but I'd like to see another assessment done by an independent appraiser for the town. Also, an engineering analysis was done. I'm not sure about the specific needs for the specific, the dedication of the specific sections of the proposed building to specific uses to satisfy specific needs. I'd like to see that.
You mean you're concerned about that page that describes all the different square foot needs of the community service program?
Right. And exactly what are they going to do?
I think that what they did is, as it said in the document, is that they took the existing community services and based the needs on this building on those same square footage and sizes and to draw their plan. So that's where they got it from, the existing community services program.
Well, this is provided to us on Wednesday night before a long weekend, and I just think this is moving pretty fast. If we continued it until the December meeting, I don't know whether anybody would be hurt, and I think that would give us more time to digest this.
Just, if I might, for you, Madam Chairman.
I thought you were getting me a soda.
The chief of police is now working. I could get my dollar bill to work.
You need the police to get the quarter into the machine.
Got your name and address there, Mike?
Councilor Berry has just described is really what is the program planning project that will take well over a year in terms of bringing in the interested parties, the Community Services Advisory Commission, in sort of a building committee. I think there was a cover note somewhere with the material from SMRT, or in one of my notes to the council somewhere, maybe it was in an email, that no one from the town has reviewed that scope of that plan that SMRT showed in there. That is in no way intended to represent town thinking or policy in terms of what the layout would be in terms of square footage used for different areas. I looked at it, and I was a little bit aghast when I looked at it. And they apologized when I spoke to Rosaline at SMRT for having included it, but they did want to show it for demonstration purposes. But you're absolutely right, Councilor Berry. That is something that is going to need more time and more work, but it's more in the time frame of a year rather than something that might happen between now and December. I'll check on the soda.
Well, if the police is on it, I'm sure it's coming soon. Councilor Swift, Kiana.
Chair. I've thought long and hard about this because I've been thinking about space issues. I'm on the facilities committee as a parent, and so I've been aware of some of the issues. I'm also the finance chair this year in the town council, so I'm very aware of the tax issues, and no one likes to be the finance chair and be proposing that taxes go up. It just doesn't look good. It looks like you've got a real performance problem if you do things like that. So I'm very aware of taxes for that reason, and as well because I pay taxes. And I've struck since being on the council with how important it is to listen to people in the community. I've met so many people since I've been on the council that I never knew before. And it's really heartrending to hear some of the stories you hear about people who are worried about retaining their homes and worried about paying their taxes and that sort of thing. So I take that responsibility very seriously, as does Councillor Watson and Councillor McGinty and everyone else on this group. So those have been things in my thoughts when I've been trying to consider what to do on this issue. But I tried to look at facts, and I know those are facts as I see them, as several people pointed out to me recently, but I do the best I can on those facts. And I believe it's a fact that Community Services is going to need a new home. They're getting booted out of their current space, and they're going to need a new home. So they're going to have to be somewhere, whether it's in this building or, parked by the wayside in a portable or whatever. I don't see portables as a viable option for them because I don't see how they could perform their programs, do the things that they do in portables. I do not see that there, as Councillor Roberts has pointed out, that there's really a viable alternative elsewhere in the center of town. In another building, 1226 Shore doesn't work for various code reasons and size reasons and parking reasons and just a variety of other reasons. The Tinsman building, I don't know about, but from what I have learned about it, it's not going to be workable. I don't think the library parking lot would be workable. The Irving Station lot, I don't think is workable because it's not of the right size and it doesn't have parking close enough so that senior citizens, they could park out behind Town Hall, but they'd have quite a long haul, a walk up to here, and I don't think it would work well for them. Also, kids who were part of the community would have to be using crossing Route 77 after school to go to after school programs there, and I don't think that's a good option either. So they need a new home. I don't see any other place we could get a home. There isn't any place available. Even if we could find a location that was, it just miraculously appeared, I don't think we could get it at the cost. I realize this is going to be expensive. It's not cheap. It's a $560,000 building. And there will be renovation costs, but I don't think that we could duplicate the space available for the money that we're going to have to lay out for this, at least in getting the size, the parking, the price in the right central location that we need. So therefore, I think the need is there, so we've got to look at the other factors. There's cost. I spent over an hour with Mr. McGovern this morning going through all the numbers because I wanted to make sure I understood them, at least to the best of my ability. And I cranked through all the debt service for all the various projects that we're doing, and while I am not by any means a financial guru, I have confidence in the numbers and the assumptions that he made. I think the cost impact to buy this, just for this project alone, is less than 0.5 cents on the tax rate, which basically means it's under a dollar for the average home, under a dollar a year for the average homeowner to pay to get this built, to purchase this building. So to me, you know, it's an impact, but it's a dollar, $1 a year. And I think a lot of the senior citizens that I hear about who are on fixed incomes, who I hear from who are on fixed incomes, would feel that they would get back in services and a place to go more than the $1 that it would cost them in extra taxes if they lived in a $200,000 home. I would agree with a number of the counselors that if we do indeed buy this building, we should sell or try to sell, look at selling 1226 Shore. I don't think it works well for our current needs. It's been a stopgap, but it hasn't been perfect. I would advise, however, that we retain an easement over the driveway so that we could still access this back lot if we, from behind Town Hall, if we were to sell that. But I would like to get that back on the tax rolls. Perhaps there's a dentist or somebody would like that office space. I don't know. But we could put it back on the tax rolls that way and recoup some of the lost tax income that way. Also, the town should be continuing to rent out the space in the old farmhouse building, the apartment space on the second floor. We have no intentions of getting rid of the tenant who is there, and she will continue to pay rent. And we would like to rent out the space, whether it's to Mr. Gagnon or whoever, where the paint store is. And that will provide us with some revenue to offset some of the costs. Public input, I have received a number of emails and letters on this. I've received two letters and emails. I also received a petition, which I gave copies to everyone on the council, signed by 25 citizens of Cape Elizabeth who are for this project. So that's that. I heard 19 people tonight speak for it. 14 spoke against it, but I had one phone call against. That's all I've heard in the community. And I've been asking people, so it isn't like I've been sort of hiding out. So the public input I've heard seems to indicate that the majority of people I've heard from are in favor of us purchasing the project. And I regret that there's been some unhappiness between Mr. Gagnon and Mr. Murray. I don't think the town has been involved in causing any of that. I think it was just unfortunate. It's too bad. But I believe in Mr. Murray's private property rights to sell the building to whoever he wants to sell it to. And I would hesitate to have the town government tell him that he should sell it to somebody or he should not sell it to somebody, because it's his and his wife's building, and he can do with it what he wants. So I have a fiscal responsibility to all citizens in Cape, and I think that buying this building is the most economical way to deliver the necessary and desired services to them. And so for those reasons, I will be supporting the purchase.
Thank you. When you go last, there's not very much more to say. I think that, but I do want to say that I think most people realize that I have supported this from day one. My job is a commercial broker. You come up against things that are unplanned for, that you don't expect, that are there, and you have to make decisions right away. From day one, I felt that if the cost could come in and the use of the building could meet our needs, it was an absolute must for us to own. There's no question that it's a terrific spot for community services. Community services, in not just this community, but in all communities, are growing rapidly. As society changes and families find different use for their times, this is why community services programs are growing. These are the kind of things that people want to do. We've just, as many people have been down for a tour to the new South Portland Community Services Building, a brand new facility that they've built, a spectacular new facility. I don't question the size of it, the beauty of it, the glory of it, but what it is points out to me is they as a community felt the need to have a community services facility. So I have been supporting it right along, and I was very happy to see that the figures fell into line so that I felt comfortable in continuing to support this. One of the things that I've heard, and I've had, as you probably heard, have had, this was not first, several confrontations with Mr. Gagnon, as he considers me to be clearly responsible for what's happened to he and his business. But I will also tell you, as a commercial broker, when you have a tenant for 10 or 15 years, and you offer him now a five-year lease, he says, no, I only want one, the message is very clear to me, and I assume it was very clear to Mr. Murray, is that this is a tenant who's not planning to stay. Otherwise, he would want more than 1 year. So, consequently, Mr. Murray has the right then to go out and say, well, I'm going to find somebody else who might be interested in my building, because clearly you're not. So I feel very comfortable that even though I have been accused by Mr. Gagnon, I feel very comfortable that I personally did not come between he and Mr. Murray. That was their deal, and their negotiations was over. He came over and spoke to us. Our negotiations began. Fits a need for our community. I'm really looking forward to it. I can't wait, if it works out, that we see the community services in there. I see the community services director down there. I bet she's already planned for the use of that space. The idea of having a small kitchen facility in there where senior citizens can not only have their program during the day, where they can't do during the school, and we know that senior citizens, including myself, do not like to be out at night anymore. I think the idea of being able to come there and have a social situation as well as a small lunch is a spectacular community service to provide, and the fact that we can do it in the center of our town center, in the middle of our community, is terrific. So I won't go on belabor this anymore because everything has been said that could be said since I'm the last one. So I just wanted to weigh into the fact that I'm comfortable and I've supported it from the beginning, and I'm pleased to see that so many of the other councilors are also supporting it. So now, if there's no other comments, we should entertain. Oh, we do have one comment.
I have a 30-second comment. Sue Weatherby is often thanked for all the great work she does with community services, and she does do a lot of great work, and everyone appreciates it. But I also wanted to mention community services a lot more than Sue Weatherby. There's other staff members who are here this evening. There's probably about two to 300 staff members that help during the year. There's a community services advisory board, there's custodians. There's just so many. Janet Hoskins here tonight, Karen Allen from the staff. I'd like anyone who's present who provides staff assistance in some way to community services to please stand and be recognized as well as Sue. They all do a great job, so thank you all.
Where are you? Stand. Where are you? Thank you. Now I'm ready to entertain a motion if there are no more discussions on this particular item. We do have several items more. Cross the agenda.
Do the honor. Should I read the draft motion? Well, whatever.
Well,
I move that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council authorize the town manager to purchase on behalf of the town of Cape Elizabeth land and buildings situated at 343 Ocean House Road for the sum of $560,000 pursuant to the option to purchase real estate between K. Wayne and Virginia A. Murray and the town of Cape Elizabeth, dated October 18th, 2000. I move we also further authorize the manager to sign all documents necessary to effectuate the purchase authorized by the council. This $560,000 is hereby appropriated from anticipated proceeds of an upcoming bond issue.
It's been moved and seconded. A further discussion, Councilor Barry.
We have already paid $20,000, so it actually would be $540,000, is that correct?
Actually, that's
correct, but I use the 560 amount because we haven't actually appropriated that from the bond issue, and that's proposed to come out of the bond issue.
But if we pass this, right. Thank you. And if we pass this motion and the anticipated proceeds from an upcoming bond issue, what if that's not passed?
We would need to reconsider this. The council would need to reconsider this item.
All the items broken down individually rather than take them in a group so that it gives people an opportunity to speak, to do any citizen initiatives one item at a time rather than a whole clump. So that's why they're broken down one at a time. Okay?
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
When do we anticipate the bond to be issued?
The bond, the work would begin this coming week. I have an appointment with our financial advisor. We could throw out the disclosure, the printing, and all of that. The closing on this property would take place in early January, and the proceeds from the bond would be received around February 1.
Thank you. Is it Councilor McCleary-Watson?
Manager McGovern, now just a question. For clarification for me, I think, and also anyone else who may have the same question. We are approaching this issue tonight on 343 Ocean House Road because we're trying to bond it with everything else, right?
That's right.
By doing this, we're trying to save money.
That's correct.
Isn't that right? So that's why we're looking at all of these items, and that's why we're taking this on, although we had 3 months. We had 90 days to entertain this. We are doing this at this juncture in order to save the town money and to bond one bond for $4.1 million versus whatever it might cost us additionally if we were to do them separately. Is that correct?
Right.
Okay, I just want to make sure for anyone who knows that that's why we're rushing. Well, we're not rushing, but that's why we're not taking 3 months, trying to save money expeditiously.
There's that reason. The other reason all of this is before you this evening is because there's always so much concern of, well, what's coming next and what else. And I, as much as possible, wanted to have everything in front of you at the same time so that you would know what was before you and could make decisions based on some of the other inputs as well.
Okay.
Hearing no more discussion, we'll call the vote. Oh, Councilor Barry.
Well, I was going to ask about the, if that's relevant, the county,
sure.
Because the county is included in here. What's the increase in the county tax rate?
Well, we don't know exactly yet.
The
proposed.
Yeah, Councilor McGinty mentioned 11%.
That's outrageous.
Yeah, it would be approximately $50,000 for Cape Elizabeth. That's my estimate at this point, based on what.
An additional $50,000.
Yes, an additional $50,000.
Addition to the $500,000 that we spend every year for the
five company. And a half we already spent.
All right. Thank you.
Councilor, did you have your hand up? Could I call the question, please? All those in favor? Opposed? None. Motion carries. I'm going to ask for just a 5-minute break so that we could just move around for a minute before we get under these other three items. Please keep us on the air. Sorry, it's an empty time.
I hate you.
Why don't they hit the sound off while we're...
Yeah.
Chief William. Just hit the sound for a time. There you go.
Yeah.
Thank you.
This is not something, in case anyone's forgotten, that this is the first time on the agenda. This has been here for a while.
I'd be happy to answer any questions
the councilors
may have.
Councilor Fritz.
I'd just like the manager to explain the difference between the original numbers and the revised numbers, particularly for the furnishings and that.
I received an email from Councilor Ruth McCleary-Watson about a week ago saying, Michael, look at all these numbers again. And in fact, I got it, and I had to go down to New York for a Rotary event last weekend, and I was thinking about it all the way down. It enabled me to think enough to look at different ways to carve it. One is the temporary dispatch center, $150,000. I realized that the way the auditors had done the audit this past year is they had already taken that out of the general fund. And I really saw no reason to reimburse that back to the general fund. The Engineering Construction Administration, I reduced it by $25,000. That was based on, their fee is actually slightly less than that but for OATS, but then we do have other fees that come up from the DEP and other agencies come out of that, and the 250 should be able to do it. The contingency I dropped from 8% to 7%. The furnishings budget for the police I dropped a little bit based on the fact that The furnishings budget was done on list price. I think we can do considerably better than that. Fire furnishings, the fire chief was off hunting. When I put the original estimate together, I did not have the updated list. He gave me a list that said 76,000, I think it was. The rest of it is unchanged.
Where is this draft?
So the chief coming back from hunting saved $75,000.
Jeez. We should do this all in November all the time. All right, is there any more discussion on this item? We have draft proposals that cover the proper verbiage for this. If anybody would like to place that into a motion.
So moved. Do I have to read it? Can I just say so moved?
You can say so moved, since we read the dollars on the agenda item. Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion on item number 53?
I just think it's good that the bids came in lower than we had expected. I think that's, I mean, we, all the towns had been looking at a lot higher costs on projects over the last number of years, and so this is good.
The bids coming in lower on these projects made it easy for me to follow my belief that we should have this millwork building. Mm-hmm. Had the bids been any differently, I don't think we'd be in the same place as we are tonight. Mm-hmm. So is there, hearing no more discussion, all those in favor? Opposed? None? Thank you. Item number 54, proposal to work cooperatively with the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust to place $250,000 in a conservation land purchase fund, utilizing $150,000 from a proposed bond issue and with $100,000 from the town's land acquisition fund. I wanted to, before we get into this, I just wanted to caution the council and to tell the public that we've been discussing this issue with the land trust quite a lot earlier than it is just now. And until it is finalized, we are not in a position to indicate at all where this land is located. Therefore, there will be a subsequent vote for the council at a later date on this piece of land when this is final and we can announce where it is. But I want to caution the council that we're not to give the location now. Manager?
Yeah, I'd just like to indicate that present in the audience this evening is Dr. Joseph Schenkel, who is the new president of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. He's accompanied by Dr. Peter Rand, who is one of the founders of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, Bob Danielson, the immediate past president of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, and Nancy Miles, who is an officer of the Land Trust as well. And all of them are here this evening. And I assume if you gave them an opportunity to speak at length, that they would.
An hour ago, I would have given you that opportunity. I mean, do you have something really burning to say?
Madam Chairman.
Councilor Barry.
I think this is the best deal, the best bargain that the town has seen in a long time.
No question.
And I am going to make a motion that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council hereby appropriate from an upcoming bond issue $150,000 into the Conservation Land Purchase Fund, with said funds to be supplemented with $100,000 from the Land Acquisition Fund for a future donation to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. Funds shall not be expended until the Town Council shall review and approve the allocation of these funds for a specific parcel or parcels. We have had, we have had the discussions in workshops, and we've really spent a lot of time looking into this matter, and I think that it's one of the best bargains and benefits for the town of Cape Elizabeth I've seen for a long time. And I thoroughly support this motion.
I will agree.
I think we do agree in that. Councillor McClary Watson.
I just wanted to also echo the same words. I'll be glad when we can let people know what we're doing, because it is exciting. And when we look at our comprehensive plan and, you know, watching what took place with the other night with, you know, the Broad Cove issue and some of the other issues regarding open space and, you know, protecting our land, this is truly a wonderful purchase, and I thank the Land Trust for bringing it to us and for being here so that this is an opportunity that we could have. So thank you for all your hard work.
Councilor Roberts.
I might add there are no existing buildings on this property. Or businesses.
That's right. That's right.
I would just like to add that I think it's a great thing for the town, and I also would like to extend our thanks for the Land Trust's work on this, and hopefully everything will come to a wonderful fruition that we can let people know about as soon as possible.
Do any of you really want to speak?
I move the question.
Thank you. The question's been moved. All those in favor? Opposed? Hearing none. Carries unanimously. This is terrific. This is great.
Thank you.
Did you sit through the earlier hearing? Item number 55, proposal to authorize the Playground Study Committee to continue planning for playground improvements and to set aside $150,000 from the proposed bond issue for planning and for playground improvements. I'm sure this is an item that people did not expect to come up. These are just some of the items that the elected board needs to deal with. We deal with something that for the whole community. And is there any comments on this from other than, see, the manager might want to report?
I just want to do a brief introduction to this in addition to your very fine comments, Madam
Chairman.
I can't
find my
This would fund both the design and $150,000 of, or which would be approximately half of a much larger project, with the assumption being that the balance would be predominantly funded privately, although I'm not saying totally. The real issue with it was looking at the town contribution. This would be, unlike the rest of the bond, much of the rest of the bond, which is a 20-year bond, this portion is only 10 years as you look at the schedules. Most of our playgrounds are getting to be in very antiquated condition. Many of the playscapes are 20 years old now, and the lifespan of playscapes is not intended to be 20 years. You know, the alternative of not doing this would be struggling to find the funds in individual budgets, and since this equipment will be good for at least 10 years and it ought to be paid for over its useful life, and since the other projections discussed earlier showed that it could be done without increasing the tax rate, I feel this is the best approach to do, and the timeliness of this with the bond issue about to be issued is appropriate. Thank you.
Madam Chairman, I wonder if you could ask through the chair, Mr. Manager, would you, for the folks at home, would you explain or describe a playscape?
A place, Pat Carroll here, who's going to be the consultant to the Playground Committee, he can correct me, but a playscape is that structure that you see the kids climbing on that can take all sorts of different forms from, I've seen mazes, I've seen, you know, tubes that they go through to
sure.
Woodscapes and what have you.
I just want the folks at home to know what we're proposing to buy.
Madam Chairman, I might add also that the playscapes you see nowadays are not like the ones that we had when we were children. They have to be ADA accessible, and there's a lot more that goes into them. And they.
When you were a child, I used to play in caves.
No, we had monkey. We had monkey bars back then, but.
This is. I have a question. This is for playground playscapes at the middle school and
elementary
at Cove,
Fort.
And also at Fort Williams too. So it's accessible not just for school children, but for children of all ages throughout.
Location.
Well, preschool too.
That is true to a point, because the council would decide at a later point based on the draft motion as to what came first, based on a recommendation from the playground committee.
Councilor Fritz.
I'd just like to comment that I like the concept of the way we're doing this, and as well as the previous item, where the town is helping to pay part of the expense of something, and the other part of the cost comes from private fundraising, part of it might come from state grants or whatever, but that this helps in bringing something along, but it's also fundraising from people who care about it and use it and that sort of thing. So the full burden is not on the tax rate.
Madam Chair,
yeah.
The only comment I wanted to make was that when I first looked at this, $150,000 is only half of it, and then I go, it's going to take $300,000 to do these playscapes. It just seemed, and I have two small children, well, they're not so small, 13 and 7, but It's still, $300,000 seems like a lot of money, but I understand that that's what it costs.
I also, if you noted, carefully couched my words as to whether or not $300,000 would be enough.
Would be enough.
I carefully couched those words when I said that.
Councilor Roberts did tell me this afternoon about a figure in the SAD district of Buxton, which was $1 million to spend on playscapes. We are up at that, but that's what the proposal was.
Wow.
So,
my goodness.
These are expensive propositions, apparently. We don't want our consultant to go to the other SAD district.
Wow.
All right. Is there any more discussion on this? We need to have a motion.
So moved.
I'll second that.
Did somebody make a motion? It's been moved and seconded. Is there any other further discussion on this item? Hearing none, all those in favor? Opposed, none, thank you, carries. Item number 56, proposal to authorize a bond issue in the amount of $4,100,000 for public safety building projects, property acquisition, and playground improvements. This is the big one. You understand why we did them all separately? So that there could be...
three items or four?
Well,
include everything.
Includes everything, yeah.
If anyone added it up, it's everything that you've done prior minus $60,000, because to help pay for the others, $50,000 would be applied from a balance left in the Public Works project, and $10,000 with some interest that will be earned after this money is borrowed and before it's spent.
Okay.
Again, $60,000 of which resulted from a call I received from Councilor Ruth McCleary Watson.
Thank you, Mike.
Anyone ready to make a motion to this? The motion is written with the proper words.
I'll
you don't have to read the five pages.
I was just going to say I'll move it, but do I have to read all these pages?
No, I think you can probably read the capitalized letters in the middle paragraph there.
Okay, well, I move that the town of Cape Elizabeth, Maine
authorizes
thank you. Mm-hmm. Authorizes the issuance of up to $4,100,000 in bonds to finance expenditures for various capital projects.
A point of order.
Yes.
I believe that the words town council were included here and not read. I don't want to be too picky, but if that's important, that it should be the town council authorizing the vote as well as the town of Cape Elizabeth.
Okay,
I understand
Add town council to it.
Town of Cape Elizabeth, Maine, town council vote authorizing the issuance of up to $4,100,000 in bonds to finance expenditures for various capital projects.
Thank you. Now I need a second.
And by reference, the total document, five-page document. It's understood.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion on this issue item? Hearing none, all those in favor? Opposed? None. Thank you very much. That concludes the agenda items. Is there any items not on the agenda that wish to be discussed by citizens? Seeing none, we'll ask for adjournment.
I move we adjourn.
Thank you. Second. Been moved and seconded. We adjourn. All those in favor?
Not a moment too soon, because we have to suspend the rules.
That's right. Thank you. Thanks.